welcome to the Lincolncast. This is the Jawbone Community's Guild Wars 2 podcast for the week of September 15th. I'm your host, selfconfessedcynic, and joining me today is Noobarama.
Yo, 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 dog!
We agreed to something, and you've forgotten about it.
We agreed to something?
Dourin, are you part of Team Brad?
I'm absolutely part of Team Brad.
Shinboy 630, are you part of Team Brad?
Hashtag Team Brad.
We will never forget.
And Rvaan, are you part of Team Brad?
I will never forget where I was on September 14th when he got that achievement. Hashtag Team Brad.
So Noobarama, you're a piece of shit. That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying right now.
I refuse to support Brad because guess what? That's just wrong. You know?
Is it because he played a bad StarCraft game? Because he did.
He did play a bad StarCraft game.
God, I mean, he purposely played a bad StarCraft game.
As someone who really likes StarCraft, that game bored me to fucking tears. I cannot imagine somebody who was not into StarCraft watching that shit.
I fell asleep during that.
I turned on the member stream.
So bad.
Like, yeah, the member stream, right?
I understand they tried to like play it up for people and give them a show, but you could not have failed worse than that.
Brad's bad at games, though. I mean, that's his excuse. That's his thing. Like, what else is Brad known for? Other than being bad at games.
Brad's good at games. Dude, he got mile high. He got mile high.
Mile high. That is what he's known for.
Yeah. Screw you. He's good when he tries.
There will never be another pulling a Brad ever again in a negative context. Pulling a Brad has now changed its meaning after the 14th.
Yeah, it means you have grit. You have the power to keep going through all adversity.
It's now a phrase said with pride.
You have the power to do something I did 3 years ago.
Oh, bringing us down. Was that a hipster moment?
Are you sure you're a member of Team Brad?
Right, it took me the exact same amount of time.
Yeah, dude, that was grueling. I just felt for him. Oh, every time he died, I was like, oh, I just like died a little bit inside myself. Brad.
I was flashing back to when I was trying it, and that was the worst.
Oh, man.
That was the best possible ending to the big Live Last Show Live.
And yeah, they will never, absolutely,
ever be able to live up to that again. We were talking about it a little bit in Mumble. And I think the only way they could possibly live up to that again would be if they went back and did the Lantern Run and completed it. But we all know that would never fucking happen because somebody would die before it would happen.
Yeah,
yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. We lose Brad. And everyone That's else when we is a quitter. Brad. They kill him.
Everyone else. Yeah, everyone yeah. around yeah, him started
Brad
quitting
because he fucking rage quits out of it.
Yeah, that was one of the greatest Giant Bomb moments I've ever seen. Like up
that was
there
the greatest.
With
that was the greatest. Like nothing
I
else.
I think that was the best.
Nothing
at
else.
Least the best. Maybe.
Like after.
Maybe.
Well, after all of the shit that Brad has gotten for being bad at games and dying to games and pulling a Brad, and then that fucking Halo 4 atrocity of an interview where like they did the worst fucking job at
I just
trying
skipped
to
it. I just skipped
degrade
it.
Brad and everything, like. For him to have done this and completed this and finally, like, this was what started Breaking Brad.
Yeah,
Mile
High
was what brought along that whole segment. And for him to have finally completed that and shown everyone that he can be good at video games, like, that has changed
he
everything.
Did good. He was honest.
Brad has single-handedly changed the game.
The whole world.
I saw that article on BBC News. I'm surprised he even got that far. It's crazy.
What? What are you talking about?
No.
What?
There's an article on BBC News about Brad getting the achievement.
Bullshit.
Yeah, yeah. BBC
bullshit.
Tech.
Yeah, you
BBC
see what? It is bullshit.
Go to BBC Tech.
There we go. Thank you. All right.
You could have kept... Okay. Like, he was so close to believing it. Like, you could hear it in his voice.
No.
I mean, come on.
Well,
come on.
Maybe like 0.5 seconds. Yeah, maybe for 0.5 seconds.
Whether or not I would go along with you guys or not. And I was almost there.
Fucking Shinboy, ruining
Shinboy,
all the fun.
Shinboy, if you'd have held on like another like 2 seconds, I'd have been right behind you guys and backed you up.
Yeah. Well, no, but Shinboy just had to ruin the fun because he's a fun rapist. Why do you have to rape the fun?
What?
I like this term. This is now a term. This is now a term we use.
Oh, no.
Shinboy is a fun rapist.
What?
Such a downer.
I enjoy spreading the fun. You know what I mean.
assuming fun means metal.
What?
No,
and
that's
yeah.
not fun.
Last
that's
time we
not
spread
fun.
The fun, I had to go to the doctor and have a real awkward conversation with him.
Wait, what happened?
Last time you spread the fun, I had to go to the doctor and have a real awkward conversation.
Oh, right,
with him.
Yeah, that was weird. That was yeah. How'd your wife feel about that anyway?
You know, she wasn't too happy about it, but she was glad that we at least had an archived video of it.
Oh God, you kept it?
I did.
Oh God.
So that'll be in the show notes.
Anyway, call my lawyer. I'll see you guys later.
It will not be in the show notes.
Dourin, yes. How have you been doing this week? Did you catch any of the Big Live Show Live?
I caught the entirety of the Big Live Show Live because I was homesick.
Hey.
Because I started my job on Monday and then promptly got sick Thursday and stayed home on Friday. Wasn't
right
feeling
in
very
time.
Good. And it was like the best day to stay home because I was able to catch the entirety of the show. But through the entirety of the show, I, of course, had like Kleenex stuck up my nose and coughing up a storm. And it was a whole lot of fun. I'm still sick. So, you know, I apologize for the
maybe
occasional cough.
Whatever, yeah.
But I am using, you know, nature's medicine. I'm five screwdrivers.
Is it beer?
I'm five screwdrivers in right now.
Screwdrivers?
With a chocolate classic wine on the side. So, you know, like I said, nature's medicine.
What is a screwdriver?
A screwdriver is chocolate. Sorry, I have chocolate wine on the side. A screwdriver is vodka and orange juice.
Okay. Does that work? I don't know.
I mean, I don't feel as bad as I did earlier today, so I assume it works.
I'm just wondering if I'd like it. Because I like the white liquors. I like vodka and gin, specifically.
It works because
I've never tried
You don't really get a strong vodka flavor out of it, especially if you don't mix it like I do, which is basically half and half.
Oh, man. You're two of those in or four of those in? You said
five,
four earlier.
Five, actually. I'm five in.
Oh, my God.
This is going to be a fun podcast.
So strap in.
Jesus Christ. So anything else you have been playing anything? Because you're
any big reveals?
Getting up to moving out, right?
Yeah. So I'm kind of prepping for moving. Move time is next weekend. So I will actually probably not be. I will most likely not be on next week's Bombcast. God damn. Lincolncast.
Won't be on that either.
I will most definitely not be on the Bombcast.
Yeah,
but I will probably not be on next week's Lincolncast because I'm going to be moving. I'm spending this weekend packing and kind of been, you know, doing a little bit of that throughout the week. So haven't really had a lot of time to play games. I played a little bit of Diablo 3. I played a little bit of Borderlands 1 leading up to the launch of Borderlands 2.
Nice.
And then kind of hopped into Guild Wars 2 a little bit, but I kind of had a hard time doing so because Cyborg makes shitty mice, it turns out.
Oh, yeah. So tell us, because we had a podcast a while ago where we all just kind of laid out what our equipment was.
Right.
Yeah.
You got the check. My equipment has changed significantly since then.
Oh, because you picked up a Naga, didn't you, Shinboy?
Yeah, I picked up a Naga. I have a new keyboard, a new monitor.
Ooh.
I wish my head
is the keyboard a gaming keyboard? Or is it a...
It is a Cooler Master Quickfire Pro.
Mm.
Is that? I have no idea what that is.
It's a mechanical gaming keyboard. In case anyone's wondering, it has Cherry MX Brown switches.
Oh, okay. Yeah, no, you told me about the Cherry switches. Yeah. I hate mechanical.
Does
switches,
it have like a mini LCD like those other?
No, it does not.
Gaming keyboards have. Oh.
No, it does.
So wait, those are the type of mechanical switches where you don't have to actually click them in to get the depression, right?
You don't have to bottom out the key to get the
depression. It's the same as the Razer Black Widow has.
Okay,
Browns?
Well, I
know I don't have to depress entirely in order to make the...
Well, there's a few different switches like that. Like, I wanted to get Cherry Reds, but they're hard to find on Amazon, and I had a whole bunch of Amazon credit that I wanted to spend, so...
Okay, so maybe they're not the same, but... I do know the Black Widow is one of those keyboards that does not require a full depression for the keystroke.
Fuck you, guys. I just have a low-throw keyboard.
Like you guys probably saw right before the podcast when I was demonstrating the volume of my keyboard, I still press the key all the way down, and it is incredibly loud. Like, for everybody listening at home, this is what my keys sound like. When I'm typing, it is that loud.
And how far is that from the microphone?
Probably about a... maybe a foot.
In metric, maybe about
a foot American.
Okay. A foot American? What?
This is me going, if I'm not being a retard and banging on my desk, this is me typing. Well, I have to make sure I don't type in my recording program because I might do something weird. All right. That's me typing.
I heard nothing.
Yeah, but your keyboard
sucks.
Your keyboard sucks.
And this is why mechanical keyboards are awesome unless you were recording shit.
I hate it. I love the feel of it, but I can understand why.
Cynic, you were around whenever I did my live stream of Legend of Grimrock, right?
Yes.
Do you remember what that Legend of Grimrock recording sounded like?
No. But
it was very similar to this.
The problem is, though, for example, I'm running my Naga, and at the moment, I've got all auto-attacking and all auto-targeting turned off. Not auto-attacking, but auto-targeting and automatic targets stop auto-attacking on Switch. So the thing is with melee is that it is not necessarily viable to run that way, is what I found, because I've kept it that way so far because I want to train myself off needing to auto-attack and using keyboard shortcuts like Tab and C, because I've mapped C to closest enemy. But what happens is, if you step even, because it's 130 range on a melee attack, if you step even a little bit further than that, so about 140, your character just stops melee attacking, just entirely. Mm-hmm. So I have to do this. If you guys can hear that, this is me mashing the one key, which is the melee attack, the auto attack key on my
I absolutely
Naga.
Hear nothing. It is dead silent.
Really? Okay, yeah. I should use these settings during, because at Mumble, people can hear me. I'm mashing the one key. Which is stupid, because you shouldn't be mashing one to win in Guild Wars 2.
So I can tell you how you can fix that.
Turn auto-targeting back on? Because that's what I'm considering doing.
Turn auto-targeting back on, and buy yourself a Razor Nostromo.
Be a scrub.
Because a Nostromo and a gaming mouse work perfectly together. It's like peanut butter and jelly.
I love my Naga.
And I love
think
peanut butter and jelly.
If I just turn on auto targeting again, but I'm worried because
It
works really well for melee, but I don't think it works very well for range. Like, I don't think auto targeting is good for range.
Going back to my shitty fucking mouse, the issue that happened was I was actually playing a game of Diablo 3, and the button in question in Diablo 3, I used it for like pulling up, for closing any open screen. So if I had my character sheet open, it would quickly close that, no big deal. The problem was, while playing Diablo 3, I pressed the button down, and upon lifting my thumb back up, so anybody who owns an MMO7 or even like a RAT7 or RAT9, I believe this button also exists there, it's the bottom thumb button, kind of on the little pad thing that
I thought it was this weird, like a clicky, sidey.
Oh, no. This is the one that is like parallel to your mouse pad. It is the lowest button that your thumb would hit.
Ones you wouldn't think would fuck up.
Yeah, exactly. Like the easiest fucking button to do. Upon depressing the button and pulling my thumb back up, the button actually stuck to my thumb and came up off the mouse. And is no longer
high
attached to my mouse
piece
anymore.
Of hardware.
High quality. Cyborg really just
did you
really
glue your hands or something? Like you were playing with glue?
Yeah, he threw some stickum on there. Yeah. Wide receiver style.
I would probably say to anybody listening, do not buy don't buy Cyborg shit.
Like that's crazy.
If they make okay stuff elsewhere, and I bought this because people spoke very highly of the MMO7 and the MMO, or sorry, the RAT7 and the RAT9. So I bought the MMO version, assuming it would have the same kind of quality. And maybe it does. I don't know. But that quality is shit. So right. I would say don't buy it. Buy yourself either a Razor Naga, or if you have large hands, buy what I'm going to buy now that my mouse is a piece of shit. And that is a Logitech G600.
I kind of want a G600 if I didn't have a Naga. I love that.
Yeah, like this is a blessing in disguise because, like, Cynic, I've been looking at the G600 since you were looking at your Naga, and you kind of mentioned the G600 and kind of described it as like a similar mouse for people with maybe bigger hands, and the kind of angled buttons work really well to let you know where your thumb is. So I've kind of
those are spectacular, by the way.
So I've been wanting that mouse ever since you showed it to me, but I couldn't really justify it because I had literally just bought this mouse. But since this mouse has since died in less than 6 months.
So how long have you owned it?
So in reality, Cyborg did you a favor.
So Cyborg, they did me a favor because their mouse was shitty and they took my money and for a shitty product. And now I'm going to go buy a good Logitech mouse because I know Logitech knows how to fucking make mice.
And they do. That's right. And I can confirm this. I've pretty much always had a Logitech.
Have my old ass Logitech 3-button mouse that works great to this day.
Yeah. And I have my right G9X now? Hooked up alongside my Razer Naga because I use that CAD stuff. Well, when doing CAD, I really like having the clickless scroll wheel because I just let it spin.
I think it's awesome.
That was the one issue I had with my old Logitech was the clickless scroll wheel.
The cool thing about the clickless scroll wheel with Logitech stuff is, well, the micro gear, let's just call it its actual name, is that you can turn it off and you can make it click if you want to.
You could with yours. With the one I had, you couldn't.
Oh, okay. Right.
Gotcha. That was the issue.
I get on my nerves.
Oh, man. Yeah. I love the fact that when playing in FPS, because I don't like using the Naga for FPS. It just doesn't feel right. Then I keep it on clicky mode because I don't want to change weapons accidentally. Yeah. And when I'm CAD drawings and stuff.
Where the issue came with that mouse was actually when I was playing Counter-Strike Source, because I was real big into that game when I bought that mouse. And switching over to that mouse, I had reset my bindings to have the scroll wheel automatically switch weapons on mouse wheel.
Yeah, exactly. And
doesn't work if there's no click.
Exactly, if there's no click.
Just kind of scroll.
No, man, you got to use mouse wheel to jump. That's how you're supposed to play CSS.
What?
Or CSGO.
What?
People do that. People totally do that. Yeah.
Yep. That's how you bunny hop properly.
Huh. Yep.
No.
You could just put mouse down, so scroll
Dourin,
wheel down.
You're just a casual, and you just don't understand the complexities of the metagame of CSGO.
I did not know this at all. Like,
this is totally how you do. Yeah, mouse scroll down for bunny for map it. People actually use mouse scroll down for dodging in Killers too.
Yep.
How do you switch weapons?
Just
numpad numbers. Like using mouse wheel to switch weapons in Counter-Strike is already a flawed aspect that you shouldn't do. Use Q. Press 1, 2, 3.
You only have two weapons you switch between. Like it's secondary.
Right, your secondary and your primary.
Yeah.
And then press 3 for your knife.
Yeah.
You only need 1, 2, 3. Like, it's not really...
And grenades, you don't need to hotkey grenades very fast.
This is why you suck at Counter-Strike, Dourin.
I mean, that's not a problem.
This is why...
No, Cynic, that's why I suck at Counter-Strike 1.6. And to some extent, Source. But with the changes made to Go, and as soon as I got used to the whole, like, instant fucking throw, which threw me off in the start... I actually do pretty well at Go now with the buttons I use.
That's good to hear.
I haven't played
Go. Which is okay, because that means I can
check. CS is one of those... Like, okay, when I log into Guild Wars 2, I can't get myself off, which is why I've been logging on less and less recently, because when I log in, like literally, I log in at 8 o'clock going, I will get off at 12 a.m. at midnight so I can wake up in the morning.
Yep.
5 hours later, at 3 a.m., I'm like, oh, fuck. I've just been structured PvPing for, like, 4 hours with Benny.
Yep.
And, oh, God.
This is why I have, unfortunately, had to, avoid the game for this last week because of my move. Because I know the same thing. Like, I know that if I log on, it's going to be, like, a minimum of, like, 2 fucking hours that I need to be on there to play the game.
Straight up.
Yeah, like,
it's not because like it's like, not because shit, that like, done, like that time is required. Yeah, like it's not because that time is required to do what I'm trying to do. I'm still not level 80 yet because of you know starting work and my move and everything.
Oh, fuck,
it set me behind and everything. But it's more so that like that game is just fucking. It's a lot of fun and like once
fucking
I start playing,
arena net, making fun games.
I know, like making fun games and not people making me continually pay for them. Like if
God
I
damn those guys,
if I had to pay a $15 per month fee for that game, I could justify not playing it anymore.
The amount of time you spend on it.
Well, I could justify not playing it anymore because I'm like, there you go. Okay, I just started working. I'm trying to move right now. I really need to save as much money back as I can. Got to afford the moving truck. Like all this stuff going through my head, but then I'm like, well, wait, I'm not paying for this game. I can play it whenever I want to.
Yeah, man.
Why the fuck am I not playing
instead of
this
working,
game, guys?
I'll just play Guild Wars.
Yeah, like it worked out the last 8 months. Why can't it work now?
Yeah.
Who needs to sit through lectures? Come on.
What were we talking about? Oh yeah, Noobarama. What have you been up to this week?
I got a new cellular device. So basically, what that is, it's like a It's like a phone, except you can carry it around.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so which one did you get?
Cellular phones.
Because you made the wrong choice.
Okay, look.
What did you get?
Clearly has no understanding of the value of money here. Because I decided to save $70 on a phone that I'm probably going to break about a year into my contract.
So, uh-huh. No. Okay,
so
noob,
fuck
wait,
you, I made the right choice.
Hang on, noob. Hang on.
Not at all.
What did you want to get?
I wanted to get the HTC One X.
Which, there you go. You already fucked up.
I was planning on getting the One V. So
why
like the very low end.
I already have that planned.
But I'm like, okay, I'm not going to get the low end
with good intentions. He went in going, yeah, I'm going to get a One X. I'm going to have a phone.
No. I went in
like
thinking I'm going to get a One V, and I thought, wouldn't it be nice if I had a One X? And then the dude on the counter told me, he's like, yeah, you could totally upgrade to a 1X. And I'm like, but there's a 1S that's $80 cheaper. And I'm already paying $110.
And so he made the wrong choice. Noob, so he made the vastly
long, fuck you. If you send me $70 right now, I'll see what I can do. Just,
how long
no, you can't do anything. It's a 2-3 year contract.
Noob, how long have you been buying cell phones?
5 years? Well, I've gone through three cell phones.
The one thing that you should have learned that is the most important thing is that you never fucking cheap out on your goddamn cell phone.
No, because but it's not a bad phone. I think you're missing out on the point that the HTC One S is a fantastic phone. You're missing out.
It is a good phone.
Down that point,
but it is not the One X.
But it's not the One X better.
One X has design problems where it has a death grip where if you hold it the wrong way, good
fuck
fucking
that,
luck
whatever.
Getting.
That's not a thing.
Well, yeah, if you're buying an Android phone right now, that's not a Nexus or a GS3. You're doing it wrong.
Noob. I kind of agree, but the One X is good.
Noob, you're Asian, so you have small hands. So you don't worry about the death grip thing.
Unbelievable!
What are you talking about? The Chinese invented the death grip.
No. What? No. That's just wrong.
I'm talking about Kung Fu.
Oh.
And insinuating that Noob Rama, who is in fact South Korean / North Korean, is Chinese and thus being racist. That was the start to end of that joke. Thanks, guys. Thanks. All right.
Fuck you.
So
I'm happy with my phone purchase, and that's what matters. But it's the heart that matters, Dourin.
You heartless monster who throws away phones
like hookers. You know, you won't get it, but I love my phone, and that's what matters, Dourin.
No,
it's what's in the heart.
We're going to check back 6 months from now and see if you are still happy with your phone.
Well, to be honest, 6 months from now, I probably have a broken screen and
Noob
be like,
gonna be
okay,
one of those
time
guys
to pay.
That thinks Android sucks because he bought a shitty phone.
Yeah.
I've used an HTC Desire, a broken HTC Desire. The screen has been broken for an entire year, and I used it.
It's a good phone. I mean, you know, there's an iPhone 5, but 3GS is fine.
What do you guys think of the iPhone 5?
Fuck Apple. That's what I think of the iPhone.
Fuck Apple.
Why?
It looks beautiful.
Well, it's really cool. iPhone 4S, but you wanted like a better earphone and you wanted earpods, right? And then you can get
the
iPhone
5. Here's the thing.
Earpods.
I own an iPhone 4. iPhone 4. I bought the 3G back when it was like the 3GS, I think, had been announced or something. So I bought it real cheap. I upgraded to the iPhone 4.
Oh, says the person cheaping out on their phone purchase. Fuck you.
No. Okay, dude. It was literally that or, like, pay a stupid amount of money to Sprint for a shitty smartphone. So, like, I was strapped for money. I was unemployed at the time. $50 for an iPhone sounded pretty fucking good. So I went ahead and,
that is pretty
and
good.
Jumped for it. Since then, I've upped to the 4G or the 4, whatever, the iPhone 4.
Yep.
As somebody who is not an Apple fanboy, mm-hmm. I don't own a Mac. I don't own a fucking iPad. I buy the phones because they're decent.
They're good. Yeah.
I know nothing about the iPhone 5, but I really fucking wish that my contract was almost over because I would buy one in a second.
So the difference is drinking
the Kool-Aid mentality. I like this, so I'm going to buy it regardless.
The iPhone 5 is the same width as an iPhone 4, thinner than the iPhone 4, taller than the iPhone 4 by a slight margin, 4-inch screen, and it's got a much better processor.
It comes with earpods, man. Earpods.
Stop calling them that.
What's the screen on the
called earpods. What can I say?
That's actually what they're called.
Stop calling them that.
Hang on. Noob, is your issue really what they're calling the headphones that nobody fucking uses?
What?
No, everyone uses them.
No, I'm saying their big thing about the iPhone 5. Guess what? They're fucking earpods. That's the big thing.
See, the thing is, no one uses those headphones because they're good. Everyone uses those headphones, so everyone around them knows they have an Apple device.
Hang on. Just to give you an idea of how not a fucking Apple fanboy I am, I have an iPhone 4. You know what I use for my fucking headphones on my Apple iPhone 4? I use my Zune headphones.
Beats by Dr. Dre.
Zune headphones. That's crazy. You'd be crazy.
You know why? Because they were fucking free. And they're not white. My phone the iPhone is 5. Black. My fucking headphones are black. That's why I use them.
The iPhone 5 is probably the sexiest device I've seen. It is.
See, you know what? Like, I don't get. I was trying to explain this to someone the other day. Like, people were talking about how, like, it's got a new chip in it and it's got, like, such a good screen. I'm like, you know who makes both the chip and the screen?
Samsung.
Why not just fucking cut out the middleman and get a Samsung phone?
No, that's what's great, is because Samsung makes the shit for the iPhone and then makes shittier phones for their own phone.
My Galaxy Nexus, I will take over.
The Nexus is a fucking beautiful phone, as is the GS3.
Yep.
All right. I say that, but I actually honestly, like, I kind of planned on once my subscription was, or my contract was up, I totally kind of planned on hopping over to the Galaxy S. So,
do you drive?
Me?
Yeah.
Yes.
I would say that aside from the fact that the Android seems to be much more progressive operating system than the iOS does, when I look at iOS 1.6, or was it 6? 6, right? 6. I don't see much of a difference between that and the 3GS I used to have. Like, literally, I'm looking at it and go, okay.
Are we talking just
phone
calls?
You've made some small changes. Sorry?
Are we talking just, like, phone calls?
No, we're talking... Well, the iPhone... I'm just talking about the OS itself and the feeling of the OS and what it's able to deliver and like, its notifications, all that kind of stuff. I look at 6. I have CS on the brain. Anyway, I look at iOS 6 and I don't see much of a progressive difference between 4, I believe, which was the last one I had on my 3GS.
Mm-hmm.
So aside from the fact that Android is a bit more progressive platform, the navigation on the fucking Google Android phones was a game changer. That was the number one thing.
I will absolutely give. Like, when it comes to the iPhone, one of the worst fucking things about it is kind of why I don't like the Windows Metro shit going on. Or whatever they're calling it now that they can't call it Metro anymore.
It's still Metro.
What is it? I've forgotten the name.
It's new Windows UI design or something.
Yeah, it's
like
new Windows experience.
Like really? Like, Metro didn't work, so that's all you can come up with? Like, really? Really? You're fucking Microsoft.
You are Microsoft.
You couldn't come up with anything better than fucking UI design? But anyway, that's like the biggest issue I really
they're
have.
They're also the same people who came up with Natal.
That is true.
Well, I like the name Natal. It's better than Kinect.
Remembers when the Wii was
Natal
Nintendo Revolution.
Is better than Kinect. That's true.
Okay, Nintendo Revolution was the coolest console name.
Dolphin. I'm sorry.
Best I'm with Revan.
Dolphin lives on through the Dolphin emulator.
I think the Nintendo was the best.
Yeah, if it had been Nintendo.
That's funny because that brings back a point that I had about kind of the Wii U when they were talking about like the codenames of it and what the name of it might end up being. I really felt like Nintendo. To really kind of show people that they were going back to their roots and going back to, you know, we care about the hardcore gamers and games are what it's all about and all that. The Wii U really should have just called that the Nintendo.
Yeah, that would have been awesome. Bayonetta 2,
not even Nintendo Entertainment System, because that was the NES. Just call it the Nintendo. Was the Nintendo with Bayonetta 2 launch title, launch day, go.
What the fuck?
I still wouldn't buy the Wii U.
I will say, that said, also, no fucking tablet controller, normal fucking DualShock-ish looking controller.
Oh, that would be cool.
Because the tablet controller is okay, but it's that controller is not going to do any better than the fucking Wii did. Like, I'm going to buy that system probably day one, but most people won't, and it's going to fail.
You're part of the problem.
I am. Because they're going to have fucking Mario, New Super Mario Brothers.
And you're buying the Wii U day one, and you use an
new
iPhone?
New Super Mario Brothers U. They're going to have that day one, so
I'm going to buy the iPhone.
Because honestly,
I just like the Galaxy Nexus more.
Like, the iPhone's a solid piece of hardware.
I'm apparently different than the standard
person. It's a solid piece of Samsung hardware. I agree.
So, I agree. It is. So my mindset on the whole Nintendo thing is, or the whole Mario thing is, like, I'm excited about the Wii U because New Super Mario Bros. U is a launch title, if it was Mario Galaxy 3, I probably wouldn't buy it. Because Mario Galaxy, not a good game. But Mario Galaxy 2,
wait,
not
well,
a good
okay,
game.
No, no, we're moving on. We are moving on.
Not a good game.
Because he's also this. Dourin is also the same person who didn't like, what was it, Mario 64?
Yeah.
He didn't like Mario 64.
Mario should never have gone 3D.
Yeah, so we're moving on.
N64 controller. Shitty controller.
I agree, actually.
I agree.
That was a terrible controller.
I agree.
Yeah, oh, okay, I was talking about this on the mobile yesterday.
I'm glad we're in agreement.
Did you guys have
that.
Three hands?
No, Nintendo. I was saying this on Mumble yesterday.
What, you guys
Nintendo,
don't have three hands?
I would go as far as saying Nintendo has never made a good controller.
No, no, no.
Oh,
Super
fuck.
Nintendo, best Maybe. Controller. Best controller pre-analog sticks.
Yeah, okay, fine.
Buttons
pre-analog
feel like
sticks,
shit when
maybe.
You push them down.
No, those buttons
Not
feel
really.
Good.
No, mine
you got,
feel
you
fine.
Got the Spree, and you got the fucking Sweet Tarts. I'm glad somebody oh, got
damn,
that.
I want Sweet Tarts.
I'm glad somebody got that.
I think I'm more of a DualShock guy than a 360 controller guy, but both are amazing.
Well, DualShock 2
I said
good,
the only reason I'm a DualShock guy is because I'm used to it.
DualShock 2 was good. I think the 360 controller is a better controller than DualShock 3.
I won't disagree. I'm just saying I like the DualShock 3 better.
The triggers on
I'm
DualShock 3
more.
Is a little, it's too loose.
Yeah, it's triggers. It's triggers are let down.
Yeah, they're too loose. They're too loose.
They're not even triggers.
But it's the right size for my hands. I just like the DualShock in my hands.
I like the way that the thumbsticks are made. I like the fact that they're on different levels. And I
the D-pad on the 360 controller sucks. Just
so
it
bad.
Does. It does.
Like the worst D-pad.
I never used
that
D-pad.
Agree.
Never used the D-pad.
Why
I found
is it even
ways
there?
To play games. Yeah,
yeah,
I don't really
exactly.
know why.
Like four
anyway,
buttons there, whatever.
So
what we've learned from this conversation, Rvaan,
just
Dourin
quickly,
is a dick sucking Apple fanboy. Sorry, Dourin, I'm calling you out right
now. Apple fanboy. What the hell? I hate myself now.
I like it. I like it.
I hate myself.
Rvaan, what have you been up to this week?
More Madden.
Okay. and more fantasy football, I assume.
Yeah, more fantasy football. Yep.
And Shinboy, just quickly, what have you been up to this week?
Fantasy football too, I guess.
Okay, cool.
And getting
and now we have to move on to the news. All right. So, wait. Someone deleted one of the news articles.
What?
Someone deleted one of the news articles off our thing. Anyway, I remember what it was. Oh, so, the first news article this week is, hey, we kind of nailed it to some extent with our... guesses pre-launch, but within the first month, Guild Wars 2 has already sold 2 million
copies. 2 million troops.
Wow.
Stop it. Stop. God damn it.
Every single time.
Wait, do you have the same people? Okay, everyone but Zumi Ramen. Okay, that's fine. It's fine. Extreme. Quickly moving on from that.
Zumi Ramen, if you're listening to this part, that was for you.
Fuck you. Fuck you. I never found that funny. Am I the only person in the fucking world who does not find that video
Bro,
or that
my name
joke
is
funny?
Peck Fuji, yep. And I'm the lead designer for 99.
You sound like you should be working at Ubisoft, not Konami.
Video game jokes.
Anyway, 2 million sales. Noobarama, thoughts?
What was my... Oh, like, Cynic's positive guessing was actually quite correct.
Yep.
No, he said like 4.
Well, that was from the one that never went live.
right.
Okay. And it was for the first 3 months.
I
don't think we'll get
I didn't
four.
Know
but
Cynic was that racist until we had to cut that podcast. That was insane. But yeah. two million? That's really good. I'm really happy. Like, congratulations.
Are you surprised or are you...
Like, after the game like launch and it's like, oh yeah, we got over 500,000... pre-purchases. I'm like, okay, yeah this is definitely
and
possible.
They actually went up. Like, they actually
it was
had
like
more than 1 million.
And no, this is after they canceled sales. Like, they had to stop selling online.
Yes, 2 million off they even stopped selling online copies. And now they've reopened digital copies for purchases. So,
and dude, like, come on. Crazy. Look how much good press this game is getting. Like, we haven't discussed that yet, but it is getting quite good
I was
press.
Surprised at how stupid people were about the closing digital sales. Like, oh my god, I can't buy the game. I'm like, there's a million other fucking places you can go buy this game right now.
And then there's the fat black lady, like, finger shaking thing, the Oprah thing.
Yeah, it's like, come on.
There's
I can't play this game because you guys won't let me buy it.
One million
like,
other places
Amazon.
To buy Guild Wars 2 from.
Guys,
Extreme.
There's a site called Amazon. I don't know if you know this, but they sell shit. Guild Wars 2.
They can just give you a code. You don't even need a box.
You go to Green Man, get it cheaper.
So crazy true. So crazy true. But yeah, Rvaan, were you surprised? But let's just open up to the table. Let's go around the table in this.
Yeah, there it is. Around the table. Here
yeah, I said that just for Shinboy. What do you guys feel? Do you think this is more than what's expected? Or
I can just, like, imagine the camera floating and panning around the entire table, like, through our faces. That's pretty cool.
Do we need to create a really badly style. Rendered CGI table? Just edit that into the podcast.
The Big
Light
Live
video.
Show was so good. The Big Light Live Show was... I love Giant Bomb in so many ways.
The Live Show was so great.
They're so great. But yeah, so in general, we're all just, like, not particularly shocked by the sounds of it. I was actually surprised.
And I was kind
of
shocked.
I'm a little surprised it was this early, yeah.
This early?
Yeah, especially with the closing of sales, because it's only been, what, like, 2-3 weeks?
Yeah,
3 weeks.
I honestly thought they wouldn't announce numbers until, like, 5 years in or something.
Yeah, I expected it to be like Guild Wars 1, where they, like, literally just went dead silent on it. And
but it also seems
like
this news came out and got taken down real quick.
Sorry, was that your boy? You broke up on Skype.
Didn't, like, this, like, news come out and then, like, the article or, like, the source of the article was taken down real quick or something like that?
Yes, it's interesting. So the people who reported on it are pretty much every Guild Wars 2 site out there. So GameBreaker is one big one. Massively is one big one. But they essentially sourced a press release by ArenaNet, which stated that they've sold 2 million, more than 2 million copies. That was the actual statement. But all sources for that press release, I like, for example, the press site in Guild Wars 2, when I checked it earlier today, that press release is nowhere to be found. So I'm not sure if it's entirely accurate. Yeah. Like, do you guys think it's inaccurate?
I could see, like, ArenaNet wanting to announce it and be like, hey, thank you guys, our game's doing great and all that. And then NCSoft being like, no, take that down.
Oh, yeah, we can't discuss sales numbers and stuff.
I wonder if it's more of like a, like, was that like retail sales numbers? Did it include digital? Like, maybe it didn't include digital, and that's why they pulled it.
Number of registered accounts.
Yeah, like maybe there was like half information there, and that's why they pulled it, because they wanted to wait until they had like a proper metric and then come out and say, like, this is the total number of active accounts in Guild Wars 2 to this date or whatever. Like, either way,
what
though,
is
like,
an active,
like,
account
what
in
is
an
it,
MMO?
2 million?
We don't have a subscription.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah, like what is it, like 2 million? Like, that's
more than 2 million.
Like,
yeah,
that's really fucking good for an MMO launch. And honestly, like, I don't know if anyone else has really, like, looked around, but, like, the reviews have been above average for the average MMO review as of, like, the last probably 4 years.
Wait, I haven't looked at any reviews for Ghost. Can you give me any numbers, what they're averaging?
It seems like it's averaging
PC Gamer
over
it
90%.
Yeah, like, the only one I read was PC Gamer, and that was,
yeah,
94.
PC Gamer, you're like 94.
Guild Wars, okay, according to Metacritic,
GameSpot,
it's 92.
Yeah, GameSpot.
What, 92 on Metacritic?
Yeah, GameSpot gave it a...
Let's keep that Metacritic nonsense out of here.
GameSpot gave it a 9.0 editor's choice. So, like...
That's awesome.
It's getting better reviews than Rift did, if that gives any kind of indication. And Rift is doing incredibly well as a subscription-based game.
But is it doing better than Star Wars?
Well, I mean, let's be fair here. Everything this side of Warhammer is doing better than Star Wars. Oh...
Because I had a spreadsheet a while ago. I don't know if I can dig it up. I probably don't have the time, but which tracked the sales of Star Wars. They hit 2 million after, I think it was a month and a half.
Yeah.
Yep.
Or so.
This is about a month.
And, and it was like, I think it was VG Charts who had some form of, like, relatively accurate tracking of how much they're selling per week. And it was literally like 1 million the first week and then fucking bottomed out after the month. And it just stayed there. But we're still talking about a game that cost, what was it, the highest costing game of all time, Star Wars.
$250 million.
$250 million.
And they were, inverted commas, a success with 2 million sales.
Yeah. They said themselves they were a success.
Yeah. And compared to Guild Wars 2, which we've speculated cost far less to make, especially looking at what they put into the game.
It should have cost less to make.
If it costs more, then better what have. The fuck did they do? Like, lots and lots of hookers and blow. That's all I can
all
say.
All the Quaggan voice actors, they had to pay top dollar.
Oh, dude.
You know what? Oh, if that's dude. The case,
Nolan
it was
North,
worth it.
Nolan North, Jennifer Hale, and Stephen Bloom aren't cheap. Troy Baker.
Like, pretty much if you're a video game voice actor, you're in this game. It's actually kind of crazy.
You're kind of crazy.
I haven't heard Laura Bailey yet.
It's even crazier considering it's like after Star Wars, when Star Wars had, like, arguably way more voice acting than this game did. But yet this game pulled the people. Like, that's the biggest thing. Like, this game, like, beyond just having the sheer number, this one was quality over quantity when it came to voice acting.
I will say that there's a moment in, I think, I forgot what the area is called, but it's the Norn, well, the vast North Sierra Peaks. I think it's the 70 to 80 zone, or it might be the
Frostgord Sound.
Frostgord Sound. There's a moment where you help a particular, one of two particular Quaggans in a particular competition that I was floored when a particular piece of voice acting was given to us.
I gotta go find that now. I've been like slowly working
I know
through that
what,
area.
I know what area you're talking
Wait,
about.
Wait, which area was this?
I know what event you're talking about, and I can't remember the voice acting.
It was the thing he
I
says
make
when
sure
he
I do
wins.
This. I have to make sure I do this. What area was this?
Frostcore Sound. It's like all the way to the north.
Wait, yeah. There's a huge underwater area
spoke.
In Frostgorge Sound.
What was it again? Cynic.
Frostgorge Sound. Frostgorge Sound.
Okay.
It's the northern ship, pretty much the north, most northmost
where,
as you can
it's
get.
It's where Jormag spawns.
Okay.
Or the sorry,
okay,
if I
okay,
sorry,
okay.
Claw of Jormag.
Broken Jormag?
The Claw of Jormag. One
Broken
of his officers.
Claw of Jormag.
Yeah, and there's a huge underwater section there. Like, there's a vast amount of underwater. And there's multiple Quaggan settlements. And one of them has a particular competition between two Quaggan. And when the nice Quaggan wins, that was the greatest.
I have to
I'm
do this now.
I'm just
going to
do
been to
all
most of
the
Nordic.
Where there are mean Quaggans, don't joke with me. They're all friendly and nice.
They're all friendly.
Man, he's... No, well,
nice
there's like a jerkier Quaggan and there's
no,
a nicer Quaggan.
No. Come on, Cynic. They're all nice Quaggan.
They're all nice.
But yeah, man. I won't go into... I don't want to spoil
like
any more than that.
Burger.
I don't want to spoil any more than that. But it is the greatest. Also, you get to swim with the Quaggan. Like, for realsies.
Swim.
Like swim race?
Become the Quaggan.
And I'm not going to spoil anything.
Oh, you got to
I don't
want to
spoil a mission later on for Cynic, but you... You may or may not have some more fun with Quaggan later on in the story mission.
That's cool. That's cool. I'm up for that. Oh, yeah. So just to enlighten other people, I just want to quickly say this up front. This, unlike the last 2 weeks where we've been spoiling story stuff, we're moving on from that. So we won't be spoiling the end of the game this episode. We'll just be talking about, well, we'll get to our main discussion topic.
We'll be talking
closer.
About the end of
because
the
it
game.
It turns
we'll
out some of us have
endgame.
Lives, unlike Rvaan.
That's right.
I just
hours.
Went there, Rvaan.
One
that's
million.
That's not that much.
330 over 21 days.
330 hours over. Okay.
It's a Kingdom Hearts.
I don't think I'm barely over 100 right now.
Let me go ahead and do that math.
That's like 15 hours a day.
Yeah. God damn it.
That sounds about right. That sounds about right.
You're fucking insane.
Jesus Christ.
13.75 hours per day is what that averages out to.
I mean, I'll be attending
you
your funeral
yourself,
next Rvaan? Year.
What?
He's probably definitely proud of himself.
3/4 hours per day on average.
He
well,
made
man,
13 gold.
Human life is already
okay,
so short.
New challenge. Keep that up over the course of
years.
The entire year.
Oh god, that's.
And we'll be attending.
You
want
to see me become a statistic? What was that to happen?
I think you kind of already have.
Yeah, you're already.
I haven't died yet. I'm still breathing.
You've averaged half of each day playing the game.
Well over.
It's not even close.
13.75 of every 24-hour day you have played the game. How
like, for all we
you
know,
Rvaan?
You could have just taken one day break, and then that stack goes up per day.
How does that make you feel, Rvaan?
Pretty good.
I'm sure he's... Pretty yeah, good. He's pretty good. But the point I was making beforehand was that we're not going to spoil the end of the game.
I honestly thought it would be higher.
We'll be talking about endgame, but not spoiling the end of it. Right. And we'll generally be discussing just the state of our classes and what I've chosen. Anyway, we'll get there in a bit, but don't worry about spoilers this episode. And we're going back to more something closer to what we our original format was. But just,
the hell
just
is the
to,
original format.
So in news, which is what we're about to get back to, and then followed by a main discussion. So my main point about the 2 million copies sold thing, aside from the fact that it's clearly successful,
copies.
Was that I was actually surprised Noob. Because when I
you remember the
I don't know if you guys remember
I warned you
I don't know if you
now I'm going to find
I don't know
out
if you guys remember
you
but,
I'm gonna miss Noob
if
good,
you
it was a good man
were you guys on during launch hour
yes
yeah
so you all remember the fact that when the game fucking launched. We like a bunch of us went back to the starter areas to see if there was a big influx of people, and there wasn't.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the kind of the point where I was like, okay, maybe this game won't actually sell much beyond its pre-orders.
Yeah,
because I was like legitimately saying, hey, how how come launch isn't devastating Guild Wars 2? Like, we had the early access, and it was fucked during the early access.
I was one of those people. Like, at launch time, within that hour, I went back to I forgot what it's called, the area just outside Divinity's Reach, like the human starting area.
Queensdale.
I went to that area, and I was not put into the overflow. I went straight into the main zone.
That's immediately a bad sign.
I went over to the very first heart, and there was like maybe like three people there.
Yeah. So
you know why, though, right?
Because everybody bought it when it came out. Or like, at, you know,
like anyone who's going to be playing. Like, what time was it when that game came out? Opening hour.
It was two a.m.
Right, people who are going to be playing at 2 a.m. have probably already pre-ordered the game.
Yeah, that was my assumption at the time. Yeah. But then it never kind of picked up too much beyond that. There wasn't a case where I went back to Queensdale or Divinity's Reach and was put into overflow after a couple of days past launch.
Really? Maybe if I go back to Queensdale now, I'll still be put in overflow.
You'll be putting overflow at Queensdale now?
Queensdale is always populated. Really? I've never been on a non-overflow when I joined.
That's great. That's a good thing, but I've never experienced that. But I haven't been back to Queensdale too many times.
So. I don't know. There's a lot of people playing certain races.
Even beyond that, like I'm logging in Australian time, and I'm on an American server. So
we'll get to that to some point, but let's just go ahead and say Queensdale, probably the most highly played starting zone.
Yeah, by far. Yeah. Well, we have numbers now. We'll get to that later, but not numbers, but we have percentages now.
I was hoping to set up a really lame segue. I'm disappointed.
So in general, I was surprised when I saw 2 million sales because I never really felt a large influx of players. Like, it never felt to me that we had more people playing than the betas.
Yeah.
It's just been so smooth. I haven't seen any areas overpopulated except for maybe Queensdale, but I haven't been there. Quite a while. I don't see too many people running around, especially in the endgame areas. So I was kind of surprised when I saw 2 million. I was like, wow, okay. That's
Lion's Arch consistently gets an overflow.
Yeah, it does.
That's crazy. Oh, that, again, during the American Ops. It makes sense. Though.
Yeah.
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 Same with the cow level thing.
God damn it, Noob.
God damn it.
And also,
damn it, Noob.
It's all about the pony level now. Fuck you. But yeah, so
1 million ponies.
I guess in general we feel
kill him for that one.
Googling your address right now.
Somewhat unsurprised because Guild Wars 2 is a good game and deserved 2 million sales, but also quite happy for Arena. I think we can just sum up that
absolutely. Yeah, like I know I am personally very very happy for ArenaNet. I was kind of worried because like having played the you know beta weekends and the stress tests and everything like we've kind of talked about it here and there in the past. Like it feels like this game feels like. As somebody who's come from subscription-based MMOs, I can't help but wonder over and over again, like, how in the hell are they not charging a monthly fee for this game?
That transitions into one of the news topics.
Logically does not make sense to me.
So, Colin Johansson has gotten on quite recently and reaffirmed one of their statements we talked about before games launch, which is he wants Guild Wars 2 to have a bunch of free content. A bunch of our news articles were deleted from our Excel sheet somehow, but in general, the idea is that his statement was, a lot of people have discussed Guild Wars 2 having paid content going forward, but they feel that it is the correct method for a good MMO publisher is to offer a bunch of free content going forward. Like he's essentially announced new quests and so on and so forth, and definitely new Mystic Forge recipes and stuff like that going forward. And it sounded like pretty much in perpetuity. Until they can't afford it anymore is what he made it sound like. Anyway, it was a post on the forums. Is anyone surprised by this? Free content, no plans for paid DLC.
Fucking scumbags.
Incredibly surprised. The good
guys pretending that they're good people, but in reality, I don't want to know what they're planning.
Again, like coming from somebody who has, you know, paid month after month after month after month after 7 years and months of WoW, like. This idea of, like, they're going to continue to give out free content for this game that is a full-fledged, like, fully fleshed out MMO. Like, they're going to continue doing free content for it. Like, I've been waiting for their next bit of paid content, whether it be like...
You're waiting for the shoe to drop. Yeah. You're waiting for them to go, okay, Arena is actually evil, but just a little bit less evil.
No. It's not
I think
so
they're
evil.
Just pushing that date back into when the expansion comes out.
It's not so much that I'm expecting, waiting for that date for them to be evil, because clearly they have made a game that is a proper MMO that is completely free to play. So, like, they've already committed to that. So it's not that I'm expecting them to suddenly backpedal on that, because I think it's kind of too late for that. That would fucking destroy their game. It's more so that, like, now that they've made this complete beginning to end full on in game viable MMO. Like, I'm waiting for them to say, hey, We're going to launch this content. It's going to be, you know, this new tier content, new stuff, new, you know, whatever. And we're going to charge you like maybe $10 for it. And like, honestly, again, as somebody who has come from, like, you know, somebody who's played WoW and paid for WoW and will continue to pay for WoW until fucking October. I'm totally cool with that. Like, if they were to announce like next month, like, hey, we're going to launch something in December. Can be a whole new tier of you know, a new 5-man raid, new structured PvP thing, new world versus world objectives, maybe a couple new skills, like, you know, that kind of thing. And we're going to charge you $10 for it. I would throw my money at them right now. And yet here they are. Here they are saying, like, no, we're just going to keep giving you free content until we can't afford to do so. And then maybe we might charge for it then.
Yeah. So, and just to be clear, they're still planning to have stuff like new costumes and a bunch of other stuff onto the Black Lightning Trading Company, so the in-game gem store. But he's made it. It sounds like he's made it pretty clear that at least actual game content going forward, and obviously we're not talking about expansions here. We're talking about the new quests and like new dynamic events and that kind of stuff are going to be free.
Yeah,
which, that's crazy.
Like, Dourin, I think you're finally.
I can't believe them. That's just unbelievable.
I don't know, Dourin, I think you're finally coming like to the realization that like a lot of Guild Wars 1 players realize, like, pretty much every single person I've talked to that played the first Guild Wars, like, for a decent amount of time,
they're
like, fucking
this.
Loves ArenaNet. And I think you're starting to understand why.
Yeah. Like, somebody who has come from the Blizzard camp and the kind of, even beyond Blizzard camp, just kind of the standard, like, subscription-based MMO camp. Like, again, like, I have played a lot of those games. Like, I played a lot of WoW, but beyond that, I played, you know, City of Heroes when it was pay to play. I played
Champions Online.
I played Aeon in its beta before I found out about the grind, and I caught wind of that quickly enough that I canceled my fucking pre-order. but I played enough of those games. Like, I'm used to paying that monthly fee. There was well over a year where I was paying for two MMOs at once. I was paying $30 a month to play these games. So for a company to come out there and say, like, we're not going to charge you for this game monthly, but we're going to continue to give you free content too, like, that literally does not make sense to my mind.
So,
and continues
Rvaan,
to not make sense to my mind.
So you played WoW as well. Like, that was...
No.
Am I misremembering that? No, you didn't?
I never... I played WoW...
You played like SWTOR.
Yeah, I played Star Wars. I played the demo for WoW.
So you played WoW 2.0.
WoW 2.0, indeed. Wait, so how much experience do you have with MMOs? Are you surprised by this announcement? Like, what are your thoughts on this?
I am kind of surprised. I was always expecting they were just going to do, after like maybe 4 or 5 months, a paid content pack that would be like maybe $10, $15 at the most. You know, just add some areas, add some things.
Mm-hmm. And so your reaction is
I'm happy. I don't anytime I can save
happy
money.
I don't have to pay for
I'm
it.
Happy. Yeah.
And so how do you compare this, or at least what they've said here? Like, obviously the proof is in the pudding, like whether they actually do it or not. But how do you feel about the idea of this compared to how, for example, SWTOR has progressed since launch?
I trust,
I've heard that SWTOR recently had a new content patch, right?
I don't know. I haven't played that game since.
No, it has. The problem with SWTOR is, again, like, it kind of goes back to that, you know, as a player, if you're going to enjoy that content, like, you've kind of paid your dues.
What do you mean?
You paid your monthly, and that's what unlocks that content for you. And for this game to not have that, I think Revan and I both can kind of appreciate that. Like, we're used to that $15 a month, and that is what, beyond just being able to play the game, like, that's what allows us to justify the money that we spend, because we spend that $15 a month, but beyond just, like, server maintenance and shit like that, like, that's what, to us, in our minds, allows the developer to continue producing the game and producing new content for it and keeping it fresh for us. But, like, what ArenaNet has taught us is, like, that's not necessary. Like,
yeah,
there is a different way to do things that does not require us to pay this continual fee to play the game while we wait for them to make this content. Like, they're going to make it, and we're going to play it, and they're still going to obviously make their money off of us, whatever the way they might do it, whether it be through, you know, the gem store or what have you.
Yeah, and that kind of transitions into our next topic, because I definitely think that a lot of the genesis of him being able to make such, like, a crazy statement this early in development and essentially making promises for a future that usually most developers would never do. Like, for example, developers have a hard time even saying they're going to have DLC post-launch of a box game.
Yeah.
Like, they're just saying, usually you hear, hey, we have plans for DLC, but we have to see how we go at launch. Like, that's generally the thing. Even when games launch well, aside from, like, some pretty stellar things like Borderlands, for example.
Yeah, and their way of doing that is generally, like, hey, pay us $30 and get our online pass, and we'll promise you 4 pieces of DLC that we will make in the future sometime between now and about, you know, 10 months from now.
Yeah, exactly. So Cole making this statement this early, definitely something that most developers would just completely shy from, is partially from this awesome 2 million sales, like, number, and it's over 2 million. It's not even just 2 million. I believe that the press release specifically said over 2 million sold.
2 million.
But
and
also,
one.
something I definitely want to talk about next, but the in-game economy, because the actual news topic here, before I go into it a little bit further, I at least want to outline it, is that ArenaNet has their new economist, inverted commas, explaining what the trading post and so on and so forth. Not the trading post, but the, what is it called? It is a trading post. It is a trading post, right? Yeah. That's the right name?
Yeah. You were about to say something that would have gotten you lynched.
Yeah.
Well, and it's not even like economist, you know, inverted quotes. Like, it is an economist. So they hired an economist to do this.
Yeah. So, like, he's about to explain. Well, I'm gonna get Revan to go into this part in a second, but he is pretty much explained what their idea is for the trading post, like how they feel the economy is going and that kind of stuff. But beyond that, have you guys been keeping track of gem prices over the last couple of weeks?
I think it stayed about the same, but, like,
yeah.
No, they went down.
Yeah,
it went down a lot.
Well,
and now
it's gone this interesting route, because I've noticed, like, pre, like, sustained trading post, it was very much kind of on a decline. And then as soon as the trading post went up, and, like, when the trading post went up, there was this really interesting, like, up and down going on with the gem prices. And then, of course, trading post went down for a while. And then when it came back up, and again, I because of my kind of, you know, real life things going on, I haven't been in the game a bunch, but I assume it's continuing to be up, because looking at the trading post or the gem prices now, based on the trading post being up still, it seems like it's kind of sort of evened out ish.
Yep.
Yeah, I've been watching it. Like, it when the trading post was down consistently, it was at like 19 to 20 silver per 100 gems, and now it's back up and sort of consistent at 28.
Wow, is that 28? Yeah. Okay.
When I checked before, the average, like, the, you know, over X amount of days average was 28.
Right. So a week ago, so my experience with it, because I've actually been keeping tabs on this, at least for the first 2 weeks. I've stopped recently because of work and stuff, but the gem prices, as Dourin said, went down to about 19 when the trading post was not situational, but, like, fluctuant. Like, it went up and down, as in it just stopped working a lot of times. It was about 19, but it would peak at about 30. Then for the first about 2 weeks after release, it stayed at around 19 to 22.
Yeah.
And that would be pretty much be the peaks, except for about Tuesdays and Thursdays, it seemed like, where it went up to about 24. Like, it was generally in the 19 to 24 bracket for that entire two-week period.
So,
and what that suggests is that a bunch of people were buying gems for that entire first part.
Yeah. I was definitely one of those.
With real money.
I'm curious, like, is this what we can expect for the kind of standard pricing for gyms? Because I feel like given what we talked about, you know, pre-launch and what were our predictions were for going into the launch and, you know, post-launch for Guild Wars 2, like, this seems a bit low to me for the average value for gyms, right?
So that's kind of the thing, right? Because the gem values are based upon, to some extent, how many people are buying gems with real money. That's almost guaranteed. Them being low at the start means a lot of people were buying gems, which makes sense. Like, you're making character slots and that kind of stuff. But Shinboy said recently, is actually very interesting to me, it going back up to 29 is a very good thing for the gem market, because to some extent, if a lot of people will be buying gems from here forward, since people who bought character slots and so forth probably have already done that by now. A lot of gem prices going forward will be people who are buying gems to trade them for gold. That's going to be a large segment of the people and reason why people would buy gems in the first place.
Well, what makes me wonder about this is, like, I've kind of been kind of keeping the tabs a little bit on the gem prices and stuff. And one thing I've kind of noticed, and again, over the last, especially the last like half week or so, I haven't been able to keep as close to tabs on it. But one thing I've noticed about the gem value compared to gold is I'm feeling like, based on what the gem value is now and what I would expect it to be based on, you know, standard economy, I feel like the gem to gold value seems to be solely based on the supply and demand for gem to gold conversion. Like, it seems like the people that are strictly buying gems with money does not seem to be affecting the value of gems to gold, like I originally anticipated pre-launch.
Gems to gold? Really? Okay. Oh, no, actually, yeah, you'd be right. It's the people who are buying gems with in-game currency that are changing the value.
Yeah,
of gems.
I thought that the real money during might be
all
affecting
the time
this.
You're riling on me. You're telling me like, noob, no, you're wrong.
No, totally. This will be the one time people will hear me say noob was probably right in this instance.
Yeah,
because I really thought the real money stuff might actually be affecting this, and it turns out
I'm actually really surprised how little Anet is interfering with this. Like, when prices were real, real low, I'm surprised they didn't step in and jack them up a bit.
Yeah,
because they knew it bounced up.
Incredibly low.
Yeah, but prices being low meant that so many people were buying gems, like with real money.
That's true. So Anet was like, "What do we care? We're making money.
Yeah, what do we care?"
Yeah, exactly. That seems to be the only real factor. Is like, people, like, lots of people are paying gems with real money. Therefore, I guess that's the thing that confuses me. The people who are buying gems with real money is not actually affecting it. What is affecting the gem to gold conversion is strictly the gem to gold conversion.
Yep.
To some extent, it's hard to say specifically.
Like I said before, if no one fucking buys gems, there's a good chance that no one's ever going to buy gems with gold, because there would be a limit, talking about your system. But if they're two separate things, then fuck, it doesn't matter.
It seems that it's only affected by the amount of gems that are being traded in that gold kind of marketplace. But we don't know enough about this to go into it. What we can say is that a lot of people are buying gems.
Yeah.
What we can say is that I was right. Dourin was wrong.
The price of gems are going up in terms of in-game currency.
This is the one time
today,
I will accept
Dourin
that.
Was wrong,
and I will accept I that. Right. You were right and I was wrong. I will accept that.
Right.
And going back to what we were saying about free content, maybe they originally had planned to do a paid content thing, but maybe the reason they decided to come out and say it was free, maybe the gem store is doing a lot better than any of
really,
us thought it would.
Really good. Yeah. Really, really well. It's clear. It's demonstrably doing well, because
it is dangerously easy to buy things with real money and trade those in for whatever item you want.
Yeah, absolutely. Like,
I saw someone
in
map chat talking about buying gems, converting them to gold, and buying the commander book.
Yeah, straight up.
That is one,
that's so much money.
Reckless as hell, and two, retarded.
But sure,
it's like over $1,000.
It wouldn't be $1,000, would it? No.
Wait, $1,000? What? No.
No.
Okay, wait. So it's 100 gold for the mana book.
Even if it's not $1,000, it's still crazy. It's still actually crazy to do that.
It's pretty close because 100 gold for mana book and 800 gems goes to about 2 or 3 gold.
Speaking of which, I feel like with our guild, like now that we are close to a month in, we need to fund a within guild Kickstarter
commander
for Cynic to get his commander.
No, it wouldn't be me. It would be Thurbleton. Thurbleton stepped up.
Okay,
Thurbleton. He's awesome.
Okay,
yeah.
All right.
He's in World every day.
In that case, what we will do.
I'm going to fund myself.
We will do because as far as I know, Thurbleton is not an officer, right?
Yeah. He will be.
He will be. Okay.
I've already decided.
If Thurbleton will be an officer, then what we will decide is in order to get our World versus World stuff funded and to make sure that we have a commander, send Thurbleton any extra money you have if you are interested in the World versus World stuff within the Lean Force or where I'm at your Mesmer Guild. And make sure we get our money over to him so that we can get that commander going as soon as we possibly can so that we can dominate World versus World for Yak's Bend and we will not be middle of the field ever again.
Yeah.
We don't want to institute a guild tax where we take about 80% of
If we could, we would have done that day one.
Yeah.
So you would have going back to the topic to some extent because we are going wildly afar afield. But I just want to touch on the fact that what's his face? I think Rvaan's about right. It'll be about like $600 to get a commander thing or $500 to get a commander thing. Because you need 100 gold.
$500? What?
Yeah, something like that. Because the gems to gold is very low at the moment. Comparatively, you're talking about 100 gold. 100 gold, and it's $10 for 800 gems, and 800 gems is like 3 gold.
That's kind of the crazy part, though, right? Like that's kind of crazy that like the gold to gem conversion is so heavily in favor of the player, right?
I'm really surprised about that.
Yeah.
I'm just waiting when Arena really drops the ball, the next thing you know, Guild Wars 2.
But yeah, so when Shinboy said that the...
fucks you in the ass too.
The gem prices were the gold gem prices was rising. That's a good thing for the market and ArenaNet and in general and people who are buying like the consumers who are buying gems with real money. That's a good thing for them, and that'll hopefully balance out. I'm hoping for it to go up to about 50 over the next 3 months or 4 months. And that sounds to me like
what have you guys bought? I currently have 6 bank tabs. This is me with 100 hours in.
I just kind of bought. That's it.
I've bought a couple of Mystic Stones because I need them for fucking around in Mystic
Field. Yeah.
Oh, I've got, but like, I didn't use real money on those.
I've got like 190. I've got like 190 gems.
I have real money for the bank money on
them. Oh, by the way, I have 6 bank tabs through in-game gold. I didn't spend a fucking cent.
Yeah.
Nice. Good job.
That was only in the first week. I stopped.
I spent real money to get that fucking bank tab because I didn't have the bank tab.
I did it like launch day. I'm like, fuck, I need this bank tab so bad.
The second that trading post went up, oh god. I bought like 3 bank tabs.
How much is a bank tab?
600.
600?
Oh, fuck okay, that. So I got like 190.
Yeah, it's roughly 750.
Oh,
yeah, actually, it is exactly 750.
See, that's the problem with going fucking tailoring weapon crafting. I got like no extra mass to sell on fucking on the trading post when it went up.
If you go cooking, everything is sellable. You can
They change cooking.
Yeah,
they did. Well, I haven't touched cooking.
Your crafting mats can't be bought with karma anymore, or a lot of them can't be, and they've made them.
But they drop more often now. Yeah.
Annoyingly more often.
Yeah, it's way too much. I got butter in Citadel Flame. I was like, what the fuck am I getting butter in this dungeon-ass dungeon?
Hey.
And you're getting
how much butter do you have? Because you should just sell it right now.
No, I sold it. I already sold it. Yeah.
It was in the Mystic Forge. It's one of those things you should say.
How much of that stuff that they made like not sellable on the trading post have they turned around?
So do you put in a knife and a butter and you get a butter knife?
Like have they backpedaled?
So moving on have
butter in the Mystic Forge. Are there new Mystic Forge recipes? Tell me more.
Rvaan.
Yes.
The Economist went on and told us about what they're planning to do with the economy. Can you just give us a quick summary of that part and what they've done to perhaps shift things in the direction they want to?
They wanted to just sort of get rid of some of the stuff that was just always on the market, but no one was really buying it, like the softwood logs and the butter, and just a lot of the low-level crafting materials.
Okay, I think the general idea was that for crafting in general, so specific materials, like a lot of this has to do with the materials involved in crafting, they found that, especially for wood and for some elements of the cooking craft, you generally be using one material far more than the others. Like you'd be using metal more than wood, or you'd be using like other shit more than butter, for example, in cooking. And to some extent, that made a huge imbalance in the trading post, because the prices for the stuff that's used less just bottomed out, because no one would ever need it, because you'd find enough in the environment by just walking around and chopping wood while questing. So people generally had the required amount of that material on them already, so no one was purchasing them. So what they did was a couple of major changes, at least I know of, to weapon crafting, I think it was, that they've upped the wood prices to craft a bunch of the weapons on there. Like, is there anything else that you can particularly remember, Rvaan?
Other than the new Mystery Gorge forge recipes, no.
Oh, but there's also the thing we just talked about, which is in cooking, now a lot of the stuff can't be purchased with karma, right?
Yeah, they changed it because the people were just like switching to cooking to power level up there, because you could just buy all the shit with karma.
Man.
Oh, wow.
Man, the dicks just ruin it for everyone. That.
Yeah, people use that to level their characters because you get so much XP from crafting.
And you know who I can name? I can name Silent Dante. Yeah, fuck you. Cooking for everyone.
Captain Communism. Don't forget him. He's a chef.
Yeah,
Captain Communism was very out there in his cutlery. Yes.
Yeah.
Zyber, I believe Zyber is a chef.
Zyber, yes.
We're just gonna we're gonna name all the chefs in the guild.
We're gonna name like half the fucking guild, because like that was the way to level.
We'll basically really detain them first, and then we'll just line them up against the wall and shoot them.
So the idea for ArenaNet was that they would fuck you, Noob. Change the amount of stuff required in each of the crafting professions, and also change how some of that stuff is acquired. So, for example, butter has gotten many drops, which we talked about a second ago. But they also did something else, which actually I found a very interesting solution to the problem. Rvaan?
They introduced new Mystic Forge recipes, so what you do is you throw in 250 stacks of, say, butter or green wood logs.
And then you get a butter knife.
Goddamn, you softwood logs or iron ore, and then you throw in one Mystic coin and one glob of ectoplasm, and you get out a Mystic chest. And from the Mystic chest, you have a chance of getting one of four blues, and one yellow, and also you also get a stone that you can sell at the vendor, and the price for that stone ranged from as little as 10 silver all the way up to 2 gold.
Oh, so do you mean the chick next to the Mystic Forge, that vendor?
No, like any vendor. You could sell it to...
It's just like a trophy that you sell to the merchant.
Oh, cool. Yeah. Like a soulbound trophy.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So essentially... Well, how do you guys feel? Because what they've essentially done is made Mystic Forge recipes that utilize the materials they wanted to balance out in the Octet Tower, specifically ectos, because I think they were going too cheap, and obviously softwood logs, which were just being ridiculous, and making something that's potentially profitable, but mainly a gamble. It's kind of cool. It's pretty gamble.
I made a straight profit off of this, so I'm happy.
You rolled well. You got three gold items, wasn't it?
Yeah, I had two of them, of the two gold items. And then I sold some of the other stuff afterwards. I sold my second Mystic Forge, because what you get out of after all those materials, you can combine the four blues into a white, and then you take the two yellows and 50 Mystic coins, and you put those in the Mystic Forge, and you get a portable Mystic Forge.
That is... I'm going to do that sometime this week.
It's unlimited uses, and it's not soulbound, so you can sell it at any time.
What?
Yeah.
Once those recipes are taken out, because they're apparently temporary, prices on those things are going to skyrocket, and I'm going to make so much money.
Hey, if you reserve me one, I will give you my most valuable possession.
Your phone?
No.
One of your anime figurines?
My anime figurine, it's a little sticky, but I guarantee you it is nothing gross.
Ugh, I don't want it.
Please ship it to America.
Did
you spread the fun with it?
how does the portable Mystic Forge work? Because this is actually something I'm interested in getting. So could you double click it and it opens
the Mystic
Forge. Basically a Mystic Forge, yeah. It just opens the Mystic Forge menu.
So
if you start moving, it'll close.
So it's an item?
Yeah.
Yeah. It doesn't, you know how like the portable vendor guys like spawn an NPC or whatever? This doesn't do that. It just opens up the menu.
That is the coolest thing.
Yeah.
It just spawns a lion's arch right where you are.
Because that is like the cool. Well, it's somewhat useful because what we were doing before is using the mists, because there's a Mystic Forge there and actually does work for PvE stuff as well. So you can just literally jump over to the mist by hitting H, use that Mystic Forge and then port back. But this is like just one removal of that step, which is really useful.
We were doing this in the dungeon runs. We were just, rather than vendoring it, we were just throwing it in our portable Mystic Forges.
That is so cool. Yeah, I'm going to hopefully, because the idea behind these recipes is they're in there to balance out those materials. And he said that they're temporary, but in my opinion, if the materials balance out the way they want to balance them out, they're going to just leave these recipes in the game. Because a portal Mr. Forge would be something that a lot of players would want. Like, a lot of players want that, definitely.
I can see them leaving in ways to get that, but just not these recipes.
Or maybe just change the recipes. I could see them
getting rid of the recipes to make away the chest, but leaving the ability to turn the other materials into the Mystic Forge.
Right. Because that is definitely something people want.
Well, those Mystic Forges are already selling for like 5 gold.
Oh, man. Anyway.
Put it on the gem store.
So I'm interested to hear, what do you guys feel about this method specifically of approaching trading post pricing for materials? Like Shinboy, what are your thoughts on this?
I think it's a good idea. I also think it's really the most interesting part of this is how they could just like add new recipes into the Mystic Forge like instantaneously, like whatever fuck they want.
Crazily, just like straight up, we're doing it, and it was there like the same day. Yeah.
I think that's the craziest part of this whole deal.
Yeah,
you can just like, you know, a human being.
We're just gonna add new shit like to the Mystic Forge instantly.
Yeah, I was talking about this the other day. It folds in real well to their whole like kind of concept of like patching the game without really taking the servers down, kind of thing. Like you know, when they have an idea, they just kind of fucking throw it into the game. Like, all right. Now it's in, guys.
Literally throw it in.
Yeah. Yeah. They literally throw it into the game.
They have a little mini Mystic Forge figurine in their office, and they went into this, like, wherever one of their data centers are, and just literally chucked it at the servers.
Yeah. Yep. And or, then like, it came like, into the game. A dartboard. They just kind of throw, like, 3 darts, like, okay, this piece is going to have that, that, and that. All right, throw it in. Put it in the Mystic Forge. It's in there.
Okay. Another thing I was talking about the other day was, when they first announced the Mystic Forge, everyone was like, oh, okay, it's where we can get rid of our old gear and potentially get stuff we can use. That's better. None of us knew this shit was going to be this crazy.
Yeah.
It is nuts.
So when they announced the Mystic Forge, they announced it as if it was a big deal. And our response was like, eh, whatever. But the stuff they're doing with it is actually... Okay, so not only do you get cool shit like the portable Mystic Forge, which everyone would want, but on top of that, it's actually having legitimate economic ramifications on the entire game.
Mystic Forge is how I make all of my money.
We have the kind of standard cynicism of, like, they say this is going to be a fucking game changer, and we're like, all right, you know what? You guys are, you know, you're introducing in-game gear.
My taint's a fucking game changer right now.
Yeah, like, it's going to be it's going to be this in-game gear that, like, all right, it'll probably be, you know, close to this or that or whatever that we already know is going to be in-game. Like, whatever.
Right.
But, like, they have changed the game. Like, they know, like, they're saying, like, no, this is going to be in-game gear. But, like, this is going to be this, this, and this. And, like, they're saying, like, basically, we're expecting A, B, and C out of you know, the gear they're putting into the Mystic Forge. And what we're getting,
they gave us weird, what we're getting alien
is
symbols.
X, Y, and Z.
Right. But what do you mean?
It's really weird.
What I mean is basically, like,
say weird alien, like, symbols.
We have expectations for what we're expecting out of, like, post game content.
Oh, right, yeah.
And instead, what they do is they like completely fucking throw it on its head, and they're like, no, we're not going to give you what you expect. Like, we're going to give you this instead. It's just as good.
It's going to be, but it's awesome, not what you expected, different.
or better,
Yeah, exactly.
But.
Like, it's both at the same time.
Like, very much linked to that discussion is, and I think our general, just to sum up the previous one, we think the whole Mystic Forge idea, recipe thing, new recipes, it's awesome, and you should go out there and make your own portal Mystic Forge. But linked to this is people have finally figured out what you need to make a legendary.
Which is
apparently
a lot faster than
expected. Anyone here? Does anyone here know anything about this? Because I didn't read up on it.
I know nothing about making a legendary, but I know people do, and I can buy it from them.
There's a Reddit post that has like a list of all of the recipes for all of the known legendaries.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did they get them through like data mining or?
But it's like,
how
is
it just takes one asshole to make like a false item on that list and waste.
No, because what happens is the Mystic Forge is if you put in four items, because it's four items, you put it, you drag drop them into four boxes, and if they're compatible, it'll okay. So you start with Mystic Forge, you put in one item, and whatever else it can be combined with lights up in your inventory on the left.
So
you can you kind of know from the start what will combine with each other. So what they've done is pretty much brute force method, put in different shit to the Mystic Forge to see if it finally gives you an actual recipe. Because when it actually gives you recipe, it says you need X amount of this item, X amount of second item, X amount of third item, and X amount of fourth item.
So I guess is anyone listening like me, and I'm going to genuinely like pursue this after the fact. Is anyone else? No, I will. Cynic,
no, you're not.
Cynic, you know me. I will.
No, I know you.
I will ask you since you know this information.
I know you.
Because people, I'm hoping that people will respond to the email or in the thread or however they get to this. Is anyone else like me where they are genuinely ignoring everything out there on whatever the fuck the Guild Wars 2 version is of WoWhead? Or wherever these data mining websites are, where they already have all this information, they're telling us exactly what these recipes are. They're ignoring all that shit, and they're finding it on their own. Like, I'm curious as to how many people are ignoring that shit, and are just
for certain things. Like, I'm not looking up jumping puzzles. Like, I'm not looking up jumping puzzles. I'd rather stumble upon a jumping puzzle.
Exactly. It's like the gear version of that. Like. Genuinely, like stumbling upon the stuff themselves.
But no, there's
legendaries.
Of...
If it's gonna take like that long to get a legendary, I want to know exactly what.
Well,
I'm
some of those materials
like,
are gonna be
legendaries.
Like, I would do this in a game like Skyrim, where I could do player.addItem, but there's no console commands in this game. They fucked up real bad.
Aside from the cheating aspect, like I would agree. Like legendaries,
whatever the hell the money thing is.
Yeah, like legendaries are the exception. Like I would definitely
money
agree.
Is F. So
okay, thank you.
Sorry, go ahead.
I think one's lockpicks.
A is lockpicks.
A is lockpicks. Okay,
I know this shit. Oh god.
I'm more so curious, just like how many people are actually genuinely interested in like discovering the stuff for themselves, as opposed to just waiting for kind of the wiki to figure it out for themselves. And,
I mean, like,
and
but the problem is, like, when you want to make something with high level items like that, like, I don't know if you really want to risk it.
Well, see, the thing is, like, especially with some of the legendaries, for certain weapons, you need to get a stack of tokens from a specific dungeon. So, say, I want the sword or whatever. I don't fucking know. I don't know the recipes off the top of my head. I'm not just gonna get a stack of tokens from each dungeon, then just throw them all in to figure out which one works.
You need 500 stacks of the token from Astral
Catacombs
for your great sword.
Yep. So let's go into this.
500 for each sword, by the
for
way.
Each?
I want to discuss what you actually need to make a fucking legendary.
I can pull up the thing.
Give us to do Kyuri.com. The first page.
You need not a job. That's what you need.
Is the legendary stuff. And so. If you guys can bring that up, I would love to hear what your thoughts are. But okay, let's start with the basic things you need to craft a legendary.
Fuck you, ArenaNet.
You need an exotic weapon, right?
God damn it.
And how you get this exotic weapon is you have to complete a specific task. Like for example, you can Mystic Forge them. So not Mystic Forge. You can craft them by discovery method and try to discover them that way. But you'll waste lots of shit. The usual way to do it is get the recipe. And to get the recipe, you generally have to complete an in-game event. For example, the Claw of Jormag spawns a merchant there who you can buy recipes for items which you use for the legendary weapons, for example. So you need one of those basic weapons, and you need a gift. And then you need multiple gifts. Inverted commas, gifts.
Or like a birthday gift.
So gifts are things where... are results of Mystic Forge crafting, I believe. Or Rvaan, is that correct?
I'm pretty sure that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think they all are.
You can get a couple from, you get the Gifts of Exploration from World Completion. Yeah. You get two of those, yeah. And I think you can substitute those for
yeah, so
else.
From getting 100% max completion of the entire world, you get two Gifts of Exploration, which can be used instead of the gifts you need for your Wild Journey weapons, so they're wild cards, which is pretty cool, and probably much easier than getting these gifts. Probably the way I'd recommend to do it. But the gifts are generally stuff that you buy, like a combination of stuff that you buy with skill points and stuff that need full stacks of 250 of top crafting materials.
Okay, I want to ask one question to the people who know what Guild Wars 1 Ectos are and Guild Wars 2 Ectos are. Are they comparable mm-hmm. in cost?
The 20 silver for an Ecto.
No, because Ectos in Guild Wars 2 are not used as currency.
Soon as I heard you guys talking about Ectos in Guild Wars 2, I was really curious about that, if there was any kind of comparison between the two.
No, they're completely different, except for name. Obby shards are in-game.
Okay.
Obby shards need to buy, I think, from the Balthazar Karma Merchant.
How much are they?
I don't remember.
Obsidian 21K Karma isn't that bad.
So what is their equivalent to Ectos then?
Well, there's nothing tradable like Ectos were, but stuff that has the same value as Ectos, there's the shards now.
So they flip the cost on that. Okay.
Oh, yeah, God. So shards, for example, let's just put this in perspective. It's about, 2K for a shard.
You need 250 of those?
You need 250 of those. We're talking about millions
of
karma.
Not for every weapon. Right?
Not for every weapon. But for example, you need, for the category, the order of magnitude these weapons are an investment, are millions of karma, hundreds of gold, and...
a ton of free time.
It would be like over 250 skill points. It would be, damn. I think, like 300 to 500 skill points.
It depends on the weapon, because if you want that greatsword, have fun.
So breaking this down, again, as a subscription-based MMO player, what we're saying here is, yo, we are all playing a free-to-play MMO game.
Yep.
So basically what ArenaNet is, they're holding you down. And then they pull down your pants, and they're fucking you in the ass.
No. If we were playing a true free to play MMO game, these stats would be crazy. But they're the same as exactly.
No, yeah, so yeah, yeah. Yeah. Shinboy, don't get me wrong. The difference here is, ArenaNet is using lube.
I like Dourin when he's drinking. This is the greatest.
All right.
But yeah, so Rungs essentially each of these weapons will take hundreds upon hundreds of hours. No, maybe 1 to 200 hours to get at least.
Great.
At least each.
But we're talking about for the legendaries, right?
We're talking about legendaries.
Okay. That's the thing. Like, we're talking about legendaries. We're talking about like weapons that will not be equaled in terms of value until new content patches are released.
Yeah, and at that point they'll only be equaled and not exceeded.
In terms of
doing it was one.
Wait. So you guys don't have legendaries yet?
Yeah, I've already got the legendary greatsword. I've been using it in the rock.
I have a twilight, and I'm halfway through Sunrise.
I have five of them.
I'm level 81.
I'm 95.
The greatsword.
I'm 95, noob. Get on it.
Get on my level.
We weren't talking about your age. We're talking about your level.
Oh, shit. God damn it.
That just happened.
But yeah.
Thank you, Cynic, for reminding me that I have a child and a family and a fucking responsibility. Thank you.
No problems. But yeah, so how do you guys feel about spending... Would any of you pursue one of the legendary weapons, considering you have to spend multiple hundred hours?
Absolutely. Considering I don't even have the time to hit level 80,
coming from somebody who has played a subscription-based MMO, and like the end game really consists of like, you know, structured guild raid content that is, you know, minimum 10 people... average 25 people content in order to really like see everything, quote unquote. Like the drive towards a legendary in Guild Wars is genuinely a lot more appealing, because it really only requires you really kind of experiencing and enjoying any and every aspect of the game that it has to offer. Like
there's a shield called Flame Seeker Prophecies. Are you fucking serious?
That sounds awesome. God. But it not only requires just doing explorable dungeons, or just doing story dungeons, or just doing structured PvP, or just doing world versus world. Like it really is kind of your own personal combination of the above. Whatever you enjoy doing, like do all of it. Do whatever you need to do to get this stuff. And really, more than anything, like it's more so. And I think this is very important for MMOs, and I think this is going to be something that really defines MMOs going forward. Like, it's about making your character as badass looking and feeling as you want it to be. And that's...
Right, but not legitimate, not like mechanically better than others, but...
No, it's about aesthetics. It's about making your character feel and look as badass as you.
How many drinks are you on at the moment, dude? I like this. How many drinks are you on?
I'm six
moment,
in right now.
You're still six? You're still well, half and half six? Vodka.
No,
that's
cynic,
a lot.
Cynic. Before we started, I was four. I'm six now.
You're 6 years old.
Having a character.
I'll say you type something into Skype chat here, and I'm pretty sure some of those words were not English.
They were not. They were not.
I must note here.
Pretty sure
that,
some of those words weren't even English.
They were not English. No. You are
okay,
right.
Can you confirm or deny?
Too much drink.
If you like, I can start speaking Spanish. I can do that too.
Talking about the legendaries, I will have to note that a bunch of them do require, as Shinboy stated, tokens, which is what you get from your dungeon runs, like high-level dungeon runs.
Well, okay, one question I have. I have an honest question here about legendaries.
All right, go.
So what I understood going into this game, and I really genuinely hope is true, is it felt like legendaries required a combination of or a dedication to any or one aspect of the game. So you could either do dungeons or explorables or structured PvP or world PvP.
It's actually the opposite. So it requires you to have commitments to everything except for structured PvP, which is my concern.
Okay, structured is the only thing that's separate.
That's fine because structured has forcing someone to do structured PvP if you can only use the weapon in PvE.
Somebody who has played every aspect of the game, I appreciate that. Like structured clearly has as far as I'm concerned, and again, people may or may not agree. I personally feel like structured is. Again, going back to Cynic, what you have said a long time ago, where you preferred, you would have liked a kind of a separate structured PvP character similar to Guild Wars 1.
Yeah, yeah.
I feel like structured does that.
To some extent, yeah.
I feel like to a great extent, structured gives you your own character. You have your own character that you can kind of outfit the way you want. Once you get beyond the basic two-level requirement of creating a character... You can go in, do what you want with a structured character, and play as if you were a max level character, and you can do that from beginning to end.
The only difference between this
whole Cynic other was person going in the for... world of structured PvP.
Anyway, I think what Cynic meant was you could make a PvP character, as in you wouldn't need to buy character slots if you wanted to play each profession in PvP, because that's what you need to do currently.
Yeah, and to some extent, my main thing was I wanted a character who I could do in War versus World and PvP, so a level 80 character.
Yeah, so this,
but not PvE.
The separate of the two that's somewhere I agree with you, Cynic. Again, as somebody who has actually come from a PvE background, somebody who has run a PvP or PvE guild and done raiding in previous MMOs. I agree with you that a PvP character who was separate from PvE who just did War versus World and structured would be ideal.
Because I don't want to level an Ellie, for example. I don't want to level class, but I don't want to level anything else through PvE because I'm just over it. And
I do not. I agree with you because an Ellie is kind of bad.
Not that I like the Ellie as a class. Well, no, Shinboy has a challenge for himself that he's doing. We'll talk about in a bit.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
But I don't want to have to level a class to be able to use it in World vs. World.
I agree.
It's PvP. I want to have a PvP character which I can use in World vs. World at level 80 and not have to level something.
Given how they are separating structure PvP the way they are, I really feel like it is a shame that they are lumping a world world versus world character in with your PvE, because I feel like that playstyle is very different.
Yeah, it is very different.
And so
going back to the point of legendaries, though, you will have, so you definitely get rewards from world versus world that will contribute to your legendary weapons. Mm-hmm. And
I think
in terms of gear and in terms of our,
I think one of the things you have to buy, the gift of battle, costs 500 of those badges of honor.
The badges of honor, yeah.
Yeah, so if you want that, you have to do World vs. World.
But it's kind of weird because 500 badges of honor isn't actually that much. Because the weapons,
it's a lot of World vs. World, but it's not an obscene amount.
Yeah. Well, the weapons you get from the vendors in World vs. World that trade for those are also in that kind of range. They're still charging like 200 to 300 tokens for an endgame weapon. So that's actually probably the cheapest thing on here if you compare that price to its like in-game relative price.
The gift of metal is going to be ridiculous. And oh god damn it!
Have you guys seen the skin? Have you guys seen like the icon image for the legendary mace? It's a fucking disco ball.
Yeah, it's a disco ball. This.
Whoa!
It's
pretty cool. This.
I haven't seen that. Benny did not link that in guild chat.
The icon images of all of them look pretty cool. I don't see a rifle in here unless it's the one I'm looking at, and I'm not interested in it. If it's the rifle. Anyway, so that was a discussion. Oh, yeah. So the main thing is I wanted to just bring up as a final point of the legendary discussion is that I think I'm actually very suspicious of there being an equivalent PvP-only legendary for each of these legendaries that's made by PvP stuff.
I hope there is.
I bet there is.
Has
to be.
Like, I bet if you reach rank 90 to 100.
What's the point of having a cool weapon if you can't kill other people with it?
Yeah. More than anything in this game, I really hope that there are PvP-specific epics in this game.
Oh, that'd be cool as well. Yeah.
I mean, really if they're adding PvP-specific Mystic Forge stuff, why not add PvP laughing. Legendaries?
Yeah, and that is what I want. That is what I'll aim for. I'm going to aim for the PvP legendaries, because they're in there. I bet it. Even though no one's found them yet, I bet they're there.
They gotta be there.
Yeah, they gotta be there. 250 rabbit tokens, whatever the other shit
is. I just don't think anyone's over level 99.
Yeah,
sorry, or over level 99.
And I have to say, noob
over level 99.
Noob.
Yeah. Well, I don't think there's any rank top tier noob players yet.
Well, shut up, Dourin. You're only 95.
No.
I'm only like rank 7.
I'm like rank 1. But noob, I have to call you out because you're laughing at me and you're not even old enough to drink. So.
That's true.
Stop laughing at me.
I actually find that tournament rewards don't rank you up very fast. It's weird.
I feel like structured PvP doesn't level you up enough. Like structured PvP does not level you up enough for what you do.
It's weird.
I feel
that
I leveled up a lot quicker in the betas in PvP.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah. Absolutely. Betas felt well, much better than
I played differently in the betas. In the betas, I played to kill, and now I'm playing to win.
And it's weird because you should play to
kill again because the win bonus is so small.
Yeah,
so small.
Cynic, you're leveling up lower or slower, right?
Yeah, I'm leveling up way slower because I'm playing to win and not worrying about kills. Yeah. Because kills aren't what win matches; it's points.
Yeah, apparently, all you had to do is fucking kill people to level up and PvP
to rank up.
That's fucked
rank
up.
Rank up real fast.
That's fucked up.
It's kind of annoying. The balance there is off. Anyway, so I'm gonna aim for the legendary weapons in PvP. That's my commitment. So we're gonna move on. To the probably the last news topic. I can't believe we've spent this long on news, but news was interesting this week, unlike the last 2 weeks. So the last one is along with the announcement of the new recipes for the Mystic Forge, they've also released a little infograph, which details the relative compositions of the people playing Guild Wars 2 in terms of what races they're playing, what sex their characters generally are, they're doing, and what professions they've actually picked. So I need to open this up.
I don't really think it's news. I mean, I guess it is that they released
I'm surprised there are more male characters than female characters.
I was kind of surprised Guardian was higher.
Yeah.
Yeah, same.
So let's break it down. So looking at these graphs, because this is a graph, so we're kind of like guessing in terms of numbers. But looking at the graphs, about say 65-ish% of people are male characters. That makes
sense. That's surprising. I'm surprised
there's not more female characters.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Diablo 3 was 50-50, wasn't it? Like, pretty much 50-50.
And females,
girls, that's because in real life.
They're really pretty.
That's because no one wanted to play a fucking male wizard.
Or that,
I played a male
that
wizard,
or,
and he was lame.
The fact that I
that or
male
probably
wizard.
Because, yeah. Like, the only race that you might want to actually, where it matters to be male or female, it's Char is not included in that. I think most people played male Char, because it doesn't really matter.
Yeah, yeah. I think most people played male Char, and most people surprisingly played male Norn.
Yep.
So no those two probably upset that
female Norn titties. Sorry, MC. Sorry.
Surprising lack of big female Norn titties. Yeah. I was actually a lot of people were like, oh my god, Norn's so pretty, but whatever.
They were very yeah. small Norn titties.
No one's gonna say it properly. No one's gonna say the way he says it. I like this, but.
So, all right, so that's the male female. I guess we're just like relatively unsurprised to some extent, but so now so race is also pretty unsurprising. Char, Asura, and Silvari are pretty much equal as third place, and slightly above them is Norn, which I was surprised by.
I'm surprised.
Yeah. I was surprised that there's so many Norns.
Well, it was the
but
second,
number
it was
one
the most
with the
human,
human.
It was the most
yeah,
human,
it's the
non-human
most human-like without being actually pure.
Human.
Right.
Because human is number one with a bullet point. It is significantly further ahead than the other
I mean,
two.
I'm saying we should overtake the Char now while we can and just annihilate them as a race.
With our sheer numbers.
Char's last. Char's
I'm telling
last.
You, Charfer, that's the big new industry. Just like lines and lines of, you know, Char factories.
Leave it to the French Canadian to talk about fur trading.
Yeah.
History
yeah.
lesson.
Absolutely.
Hey, fuck you. Don't call me a French Canadian. Fuck you.
I wish they just put numbers on these, because I can't really guess the numbers from these graphs. But it looks like Char's only slightly behind Asura and Silvari. But how do you guys feel about that? How does that compare to other MMOs you've played? Obviously, humans is a holdover from Guild Wars 1 to some extent. Like, obviously,
the thing is, like,
I mean, I don't
when
find it surprising
Guild Wars
at all.
2 was first released, or first mm-hmm. announced, and they're like, yeah, you can play as Char. Everyone's like, I'm going to play as Char. I'm going to play as Char.
Yeah, no one played Char.
And
no one
everyone saw how slow they look when they're actually galloping because of the balanced running speed, and everyone was
like
I'm
I honestly thought Norn and Silvari would be like the lowest picked races, probably Norn, but it turns out they're not.
No, they're not, yeah, at all.
I thought human would be like tied out with Char, but not even fucking close.
Not even close.
I thought human being the leader, I just didn't think it would be this big.
The person who had an interesting perspective though is Dourin. Are you still with me? Have you passed out yet?
I think he said he was going AFK real quick.
Yeah,
I think he was going to bomb
in the battle. So his perspective was that in World of Warcraft, humans is pretty much very much not the top played class. And in general, obviously that has something to do with the Alliance and Horde split there. You can't play human as Horde, I believe. But how do you guys feel about humans being the number one play terms of aesthetics? Humans. Like, obviously,
not surprising at all.
Yeah,
not surprising.
We recommended them in terms of like their
areas. I
want to
see the graph for
like
human
like
male female distribution. Like, I bet that's drastically different.
Oh, than overall male female distribution? Yeah. I bet that's 50-50.
I bet there's more females.
I don't
I would
know,
bet
like,
there is more
dungeon runs where like everyone's been a human character. It's really not
for some thing. Reason. I see more female casters than male casters.
Yeah, because the light armor looks better. Yeah,
yeah, they're all skimpy.
Yeah,
did you see
my waifu is
Sookie's
not
armor for like heavy a armor, good 40 so. Levels? It was horrendous.
Wait, hang on, Noob. What are you saying about me?
Durin's back. Durin.
I'm playing a human female elementalist. What are you saying about me?
Your character is a skimpy slut. And,
oh shit!
Yeah,
okay,
bam.
My wife, who's the
hashtag shots fired.
She's wearing fucking like okay. Some of the guys in the guild can definitely.
There's that picture I have. Attest
to this.
Put on the forums.
Yeah.
Yep.
What you put on the forum?
No, God, no, no.
Okay.
No, he's not talking about your character.
Gold
talking about
character is very
elemental.
My character is very skimpy, to say the least. She's very.
Oh, yeah.
She's wearing dragonfly armor.
Yeah.
She made for herself.
Yeah.
And that is literally three dragonflies
on
her nipples.
It is very, like, Terra style revealing.
There you go. But what I actually think, I'm happy you jumped in before I was about to move on. But Dourin, what's your perspective on the human dominance in Guild Wars 2?
It's weird
compared to what you've been used to.
It's weird because like as somebody who has played, you know, again, kind of like we talked about before the podcast, a little bit during. No, I've played a lot of MMOs. I played, you know, going back as far as you know, Final Fantasy XI. I played a lot of WoW. I played some Lord of the Rings. I played some Star Wars. I played some Terra. Played some Rift, and you know, in between, a lot of MMOs. The human style of character has not generally been kind of in the forefront of player creation. So it's really, really weird to me, not only because of the fact that that is clearly the kind of at the forefront of player preference in this game, but more so that is just generally and kind of for everybody. Like, for me personally, like, most of my characters are human.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. I think all of us have human mains, right?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
I think so.
That is insane. Yeah, that's
crazy.
There,
like,
you go.
As somebody who's played a lot of WoW, a lot of Star Wars, a lot of other games, like, the idea
that the majority... Star Wars humanoid.
Well, that's the thing. Like, Star Wars, you know, it's human.
I would only
chiss.
Play Gungan when I played Star Wars.
I played...
You know, Jar Jar.
I don't remember what they were called, but it was basically
the blind ones?
Like, yeah,
Miraluka?
Miraluka, thank you.
Whatever.
I played a Miraluka, which is basically a human that is blind. That is really the differentiating factor of them.
They have no eyeballs.
That's where it starts and ends.
They have no eyeballs. That is
so I had a fucking rag
difference.
Over my face.
Did they just bleed out of their eye holes?
I was a human with a rag over my face.
Yeah.
Right.
So, like, to have, like, the humans kind of be the like, majority race in this game is really weird to me. Like, I spent a lot of years in WoW. I spent 6+, like, hardcore into WoW, where humans, like, I made fun of people who played humans. Because I was like,
wow.
I was like, you know, where I was playing on the Alliance, so I was like, you know, you have elves, you have gnomes, you have dwarves. You have Draenei.
You have all these choices. Why would you pick human?
Exactly. You have all these choices. Like, you are a human. You can play that in real life. Why would you play that in a fantasy game? Like,
but hey,
you can play this cool elf in a fantasy game.
But Guild Wars 2 totally switches it up because humans are so awesome.
My fucking main is a goddamn human female. Like, what the fuck? Where did this fucking paradigm shift?
What do you think was the contributing factor? I know you're not at your best mental capacity, but if you can rein it in for me.
That's the thing, Cynic. I am at my best human capacity. So here's the rein. All right. I'm going to break it down for everybody. All right. Here's the thing. I'm going to break it down for everybody. All right. Here's the thing. In Guild Wars 2.
The DX music now.
In Guild Wars 2. The reason I play a human, maybe not so much female, that's more so just because I'm playing an elementalist, and, you know, women look better in dresses. I think we can all agree to that.
Yep.
Okay.
Light armor is better.
Okay.
Jaeger might agree
that,
with that, but
I hear that, Revan.
All right. We can generally agree
with
that.
Your man dress sucks.
You calling me out of my man dress?
Yeah, I am calling out your man dress. What are you going to do about it?
Man dresses,
we all come in on your man dress.
I think man dresses are
I think your man is a skimpy whore,
so,
as well as Dourin's character.
Yeah.
Let Dourin finish. He's struggling here. Come on.
That's fair, really bad character name. My character is kind of a whore. But anyway.
There's that picture.
What makes a difference in Guild Wars 2, and as somebody who has generally very, very heavily steered away from the human archetype in MMOs since, like, 2004. I think the biggest thing in Guild Wars 2 that really drew me towards humans and made that kind of be my general, like, Guild Wars 2 experience is kind of the story. Like, the story of the humans is very, very interesting.
Really? I didn't know it was a story at all. I thought it was the aesthetics.
No, it is absolutely... Like, the aesthetics helps a little bit. Like, the gear looks really good on humans. And specifically with light armor, it looks good on human females. I will not argue with that. I'm a married man.
It was designed by a woman. So.
And as a married man, I will attest to that. Like, the design looks good. But... Like, more importantly,
in a non-sexual way, just the design, the fabric, and everything.
Some of it looks legitimately non-sexual.
I'm not fapping to my character. Okay, let's be real here, Noob.
You what to your what?
I'm That's not. Disgusting. I'm not.
He's gonna regret. To he's gonna game. Regret that one.
God damn it! God damn Go, it!
So generally, it's a storyline for you, Dourin. Would you say?
For me, it's a storyline. Like the human storyline is very interesting. I played a little bit of the Norn. I played a little bit of the Savari. I played a little bit of Asura. And really, the human storyline. I play as Machar, but it's not super interesting. It's okay. It's better than I thought it would be, but it's not. But the human storyline.
It's no human.
Exactly. The human storyline. It's interesting because they go beyond kind of the basic things you expect out of a human character. Kind of the anti-hero that a lot of MMOs try to do with humans. The human storyline, they at least with the noble storyline, because that's what I chose. They go the route of kind of the real evil that exists within humans, where there is no, like, the humans are not the good guys. Like, the humans are flawed in a very, very serious way. And, like, just when you think that maybe you have caught the quote-unquote bad guy, you find out that, like, no, he was being manipulated by another guy who was maybe further up the chain of command and was even worse than the guy you thought you were going after.
I love it because in this game, political humans thing. Are fucking humans.
Yeah,
like there are good ones and there are bad ones.
Exactly,
and
it's not like they're awesome totally. Especially out to make humans as evil or very good. It just
totally.
You know, they're just humans. Like,
what Cyndi described is exactly what I felt like. Like humans are humans. Like they are. There are the good and there is the bad, and they lay it all out for you.
Which is kind of great. I want to move on to the next one because the classes are probably perhaps a little more interesting, but we'll hit the crafting ones very quickly. But I want to note that it's an awesome difference in your original statement, which was why would you play a human? You can play that in real life, but somehow they've hit an interesting point where because most other games don't do the humanity very well, they don't present a distributed kind of system like spectrum of morals for humanity. They use the good, bad, or like the opposite. Like for Mass Effect, it's a bad. Like humanity is kind of one beat in Mass Effect. Like the race as a whole is an upcoming thing. Like you can kind of like narrow them down to a very small description. But in Guild Wars 2, humans are so human. It's somewhat different, and it makes it interesting again. I think that's pretty cool. But I do want to move on. So let's just hit crafting really quickly for the crafting professions. They're all around. Pretty much everyone is.
I bet the only reason cooking is so high is because of those assholes who ruin cooking for me. And everyone who
they're pretty much even.
Yeah, they're pretty even. Like
weaponsmithing is a little bit high, which makes sense because it can be used by a lot of different professions. But other than that, it's pretty even.
Yeah, I think the one that's low, like specifically low, is what is that? That's artificing, I think.
Yeah, that's artificing.
Yeah,
no one wants to focus.
Yeah, no one wants to focus. So or a scepter. Hey. You can just buy that off the auction house. Like, to some extent, like the stuff you can get for jewel crafting, for example, or armor smithing or light armor smithing, is more beneficial personally to the people, in general than you would get out of like, I think for the materials invested, than you'd get out of artificing specifically because it doesn't seem to do anything that you really need. Of course, if you're a caster, for example, if you're a mesmer, right, that's a light armor class that uses weapons. You'd probably want actually weaponsmithing and light armor rather than making scepters and focuses through artificing, crazily enough, because they have done a good job of giving the caster classes interesting weapons to use. Like, again, for elementalist, you can go dagger, and that's weaponsmithing again. So,
except it's not viable. Greatsword or sword.
Yeah, greatsword, sword.
Dagger's not viable.
Shh. Different
for necromancer, anywhere. You can go, you can go.
I have seen some dagger alleys running around. They are doing fine
on PvE. Yeah.
Well, we get there. We'll get there.
Yeah, we'll get there.
Slow down. So, in general, it's unsurprising that artificing is low. Everything else is about equal. I'm surprised that armor smithing is so low.
Actually,
looking at how many. Well, there's only two heavy armor professions. That's probably why.
Yeah,
but
that makes sense.
Yeah.
I'm surprised that artificing is as low as it is, considering so many elementalists prefer, it seems like,
staff.
Yeah.
And yeah, staff. But that's just one class. Like, for example, as we said earlier, a mesmer would probably prefer a greatsword at the moment, which is weaponsmithing.
And they're cooler, just because they're cooler.
Yeah. Anyway, so that's that. Everything's pretty equal there. The interesting one, though, is the classes. So who wants to start? Shinboy, what are your thoughts on this? Give us a rundown of what the order is like, and what are your thoughts?
It's pretty much the three that you would think would be the top three, the three main archetypes. Your warrior, your ranger, and your mage, your elementalist, are the top three, which pretty much makes sense. And mesmer being the lowest, mesmer and engineer, which are probably unique classes to the game at the bottom, also makes sense. So I'm not really surprised by this at all.
Yeah, and then you have... Okay, so I'm surprised...
Low.
Yeah, I'm surprised with two. A little bit up there.
Specifically, the ranger being ahead of guardian was surprising to me, because I've seen way more guardians than I have rangers, in PvP at least.
I've seen a lot of rangers in PvE. It's crazy.
I've seen a lot of rangers in World v. World. Like, I ran past a group that was just like 20 rangers and a bunch of bears.
And
I was so scared.
That could be it. Like, Wolf vs. World is really good for rangers. Like, for example, their Warhorn buff swift, that gives swiftness to all their allies. Axe is a very good weapon. So.
And the fact that they're better the further away they are with the longbow.
Yeah, with the longbow. It's a very mesmer.
Just AoE the doors so no one can get in.
Yeah. In PvP, they're a very self-sufficient class. Like, especially, I've heard many stories of rangers just aggroing entire mobs with their pet to get a crafting node. Like, that just stuff as simple as that is really good for rangers.
People who have gone AFK at events, left their pets on aggressive or whatever they do with the pets, and just had it attack things so they get credit for the events.
That is pretty cool.
And get an experience that way.
That's inverted commas. Pretty
I hope
cool.
They get banned.
Yeah.
People are reporting them now, because they're doing the same thing to engineers' turrets, where like leave their turrets up in certain spots so they couldn't get hit.
Right.
And they would just get all the experience from that.
And enemies don't really target those much, so it's kind of a win-win for those guys. But yeah, I guess that's pretty cool in terms of rangers. But specifically guardians, though, I would have thought like the light. Like the warrior ass, like I would have thought guardian appealed to more people than the warrior would.
Yep,
I thought that
sounded straight up warrior archetype.
Like, doesn't it, when you make your first character, it defaults to warrior, doesn't it?
That's true.
Or at least it did. Like, it defaults to warrior.
I don't think it defaults
to Norn too.
I actually don't think it defaults at all at the moment. I think it just gives you the 8. But warrior's top left. But it just gives you the 8, and you have to mouse over them to see the description and click them to get an option come up.
Yeah,
I think.
Also, I think it's just because like warriors have a much bigger weapon set than any other.
Warriors
class.
Are warriors. That's why
warriors are good.
One.
Warriors are good. That's kind
of
why
people get that and understand that they don't need to think of like what would warriors.
You're a dude
do?
With a big sword and you hit people with it.
Yeah, it's very simplistic.
And it's like a pleasant surprise when you realize it's not just a great sword. You get a fucking
shield,
rifle,
longbow, machine gun, rocket
dual
launcher.
Swords.
Yeah. Super laser,
Karzuka.
So warrior being the top, I'm not too surprised. I was a bit surprised by guardian. I was the most surprised of all of this to see necromancers not at the bottom. Because necromancers are in the middle of the pack, which is kind of cool.
Actually, other than Treherne or whatever the fuck that stick man's
Treherne?
Name is. Treherne? Excuse me, my name's Treherne, not Treherne.
My name is Treherne.
Treherne would fit.
Tree fern.
You don't talk mess.
Fuck you guys.
Don't talk mess about Treherne like that. He'll fuck you up.
What were you saying, Noob? Do you have a point, or did you just want to say tree?
Yeah, there's not. Other than I don't encounter many fucking necromancers in PvE
or PvP, and yet
okay.
There's a bunch made. I guess because this is characters made. I've queued up a necromancer. In terms of like just left a character there just in case I want to play him later. Like that, do you think a lot of that is contributing to some of these numbers here? Like people queuing up their ults?
I don't think so.
Oh, that's possible.
Maybe.
No.
I don't think it would affect the graphs
that much. Then I would expect
mesmers
to be way higher.
Maybe, yeah.
And I would expect thieves to be much higher because at this point...
Well, thieves are higher than they should be, to be honest.
And if it's just all... I don't know. then I think Guardians should be higher. And
can I just point out how awesome the like logo for Thief is?
Yeah, yeah. A knife and a key. That is pretty
that's,
cool.
That's like the obvious idea for a thief. Like a helmet could also mean like a guardian, but like thief. Come on, that's what a thief is.
Yeah,
exactly. It's my favorite logo.
Yeah, it's a pretty damn cool. Well, I actually like the Mesmer the most. Just a fucking butterfly, because you know, fuck
the butterfly mask.
Love them. Yeah, also, they should have been purple in this graph. That's lame. Yeah. What the fuck?
Well, if you look, it's just red to that greenish color from left to right.
Yeah, yeah, but still purple.
For the professions, they should have done the profession color.
Yeah,
they did the rainbow thing like we did in that dungeon, Shinboy. Remember the rainbow dungeon run?
Rainbow run.
We looked so good.
We did.
Reading rainbow.
We looked fabulous.
So with that, just to lay it out for anyone who didn't really notice, that war is out front by a small amount, followed by ranger, elementalist, guardian, thief, necro, and then it looks like there's splitting distance between engineer and mesmer at the bottom, and that's pretty. Aside from Thief and perhaps Guardian, that's pretty much as expected. That's pretty cool.
It's really weird, like, the mesmer in between the two large towers that is the Ranger and the Warrior. It seems so small.
So small. But mesmers are an awesome class at the moment. It's weird. In PvE, they're kind of underpowered, but from major like, popular opinion, at least. I haven't played one. But in PvP, they're fucking OP.
They're
I know
my level 91 PvE mesmers for swiftness. Well.
Yeah.
Swiftness, no, quickness.
Quickness.
I always get those two messed up. God damn it.
Yeah.
So now we have a decision, right? Because we've discussed news far longer than I even remotely expected.
At this point, it's no longer news. They're just actual discussions that are in the guises of news.
Let's just go straight into dungeons. Good idea, Shinboy.
That's kind of the thing. Because our general idea for this episode was to talk about what we picked at the start of the game. And to talk about how we feel that has developed over the last 3 weeks. But because we don't have much time left, and it's kind of the same discussion to some extent to talk about the dungeons. And I love talking about dungeons, as we've probably told the last two episodes. Because it is pretty much the highest tier of PvE.
Now you get to discuss dungeons with the Lincoln Force head of dungeoneering.
What about the Calibre?
So instead of going into the overall
completely ignored, dominated
class balances and that kind of stuff, we'll probably talk about that next week instead and do a proper state of the game next week, assuming there's not a shitload of news like there was this week. And we've touched on all the professions a little bit in this episode, just in general. But for this episode, I'm going to change it from the show notes, and let's just talk about the head of dungeoneering talking about dungeoneering Guild Wars 2 and how you feel that's going at the moment and how the classes are going in the moment in that context. So Shinboy, you're the head of dungeoneering for Lincoln Force, aren't you?
I am the head dungeoneer.
He has an office and a desk and everything. It's really cool in the Lincoln Force offices.
Yeah, Noob's my secretary.
Wait, I didn't even have an office. I'm a guild leader. Fuck you guys. It's because I'm in Australia, isn't it? God damn it.
No, it's because your skin color is brown.
No, your desk is made of giant Australian spiders.
Well, I paid for Shinboy.
That's scary.
That's my normal desk.
I'm getting nightmares. Don't do that.
God damn it.
Shinboy funded his office using the dungeon run, so.
Yeah, I probably
that explains it.
So if you could give me a typewriter. And then the gems to money, I probably could fund it.
Can you give me an idea of what the Linking Force guys have been doing in dungeons over the last couple of weeks, Shinboy?
There's been a lot of like random story modes. I've noticed as the guild has progressively leveled up, like it went from a lot of AC runs to a lot of Cauticus Manor runs, and now I'm starting to see a lot of more Twilight Arbor runs forming. But most of the level 80 guys, and I'm taking credit for starting this within guild, but I did not by any means figure out this run. We've been doing a lot of Citadel of Flame explorable runs because they are awesome.
So the general thing with Linky Force and Dungeon, we've talked about dungeons both last episodes, and I'm sorry to the audience out there if you don't care about dungeons. I think that you're wrong and you should care about them because they're awesome. But
this is coming
from
a PvP player.
Exactly, and I main PvP at the moment, and I was planning to talk about that, but we don't have time for it. But we've given you 2.5 hours of entertainment. We're going to that dungeon now. If you don't want to talk about dungeons, I'm giving you permission to tap out. But I want to talk about dungeons more because not enough people do them, and I think they're amazing. To some extent, there are definitely holes in this, but to some extent, they are absolutely amazing. So what we started doing is like. As we've progressed, more and more people in the guild have slowly started moving from general, like, generic PvE and moving through his personal storylines to dungeons to the point where I still haven't progressed past level 56 personal story. at all. Like, I went all the way into dungeons, and now I'm all the way into PvP, and both of those are so awesome that I've never been around. So we've seen people progressing to dungeons, more people doing dungeon runs, and I kind of want to go into not the dungeons themselves, because we talked about that in previous episodes, but what dungeons can turn into, and what they're heading towards, and how the classes fare into this. So you specifically are working on speedclears, finally. Is that correct? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's one. Citadel of Flame is the one that's probably the most polished right now.
Yep.
But AC could,
which is a surprise.
We could polish that really easily to probably around 35 minutes, depending on which path we take. And we went in blind into Twilight Arbor and got that done in 50 minutes with a few wipes. And there's one part in particular. I'm not going to say which part it is, because that'll ruin the explorable for people that haven't done it. But there's one part where if we do that right, we could probably cut that run down from 50 minutes to 30 minutes without much issue at all.
So I guess the audience would kind of get what we mean by speed clear by that little synopsis there. But can you run me through what's the mentality behind a speed clear? What's your process of developing a speed clear? And how do you think that factors into the dungeons?
The way I'm doing it now is I'm just inviting whoever wants to come. I'll start in guild chat, you know, COF, explorable, who wants to come with me? And normally Revan's online because he's online three quarters of the day. So he's been joining me a lot. But I've been taking mental notes on which professions.
Gotta figure out when he's not online, because that's very rare.
So what I want to try is, and Cynic, you can get involved in this too, because you're one of these professions. I want to try a speed clear with two Ellies, two Warriors, and a Guardian.
Right.
To get, like, see if we can get that down, because the current run, I need to look at the screenshot, because I don't remember the party composition. I think it might have been two Guardians in there. But we got one 19-minute run, which is my current best.
Right. For Citadel Flame?
For Citadel Flame Explorable, yeah.
So your general process of developing these runs is to... You played through most of the Explorables now, at least one path of most of them, is that right?
Or no, I've done CM... I'm just going to throw acronyms in there. AC, CM, TA, COF, and I think that's it.
Have you done Ara?
Paths of AC. Ara, no, because Ara is broken.
Broken.
Okay.
You can't, like... I've heard from multiple different people that you just cannot finish it.
But aren't there multiple paths? I would assume at least one path.
Yeah, the way speedcores work is there's one path you take every single time.
Yeah.
Like in COF, it's the middle one. You got to help Mag, who's this little Asura. And in AC, Ghost Eater is the dude called?
Yeah.
Something like that.
Ghost Eater is the easiest.
But you can also, the one that we did, Colossus Rumbless, I was talking to friends of mine. Like, I have contacts all over the place. This is crazy. Who did that in 50 minutes with people who didn't really know what they were doing. Like, I know a lot of those guys, and some of them are really good players. Some of them are kind of bad, and they apparently took some of the kind of bad people.
Okay.
So
the general idea is you run a dungeon. Usually you'd either research it or run each path of it to get experience for yourself. And
yeah, the way we did Twilight Arbor is we heard that one way was easier, so we decided to do it that way. But other than that, we knew nothing about how any of the fights worked or anything.
Yeah.
So we went in blind.
So, and the whole thing about explorable modes is you have the explorable mode dungeon, which is entirely different from a story mode type, and it usually has multiple paths to it. And I think it's from 3 to 4. I don't think there's any more than 4. Are there any of these? I think there's 3 max, right?
Yeah, I haven't seen more than 3.
No, I think Ara has
5,
including the story mode is 5.
Oh no, not including the story mode, which just in the actual paths themselves. I think it's still 4.
It's 4. Yeah, Ara has 4 according to the achievement.
So the general idea is to either crowdsource your information or to run it yourself to get an idea. And I prefer that way because I love the hard part of doing dungeons. But you run the dungeons with a specific composition in these explorative modes, which are difficult to some extent in a lot of cases. And to see how you go, and you look at your efficiencies, you document your, at least mentally document your processes, and you figure out the trick, inverted commas, to each of the major obstacles in that dungeon. And then, this is probably known to some people out there, but generally you're going to be forming efficient paths, efficient classes, best case scenarios for each of those scenarios, best case applications to each of those scenarios in terms of what people should be playing and what kind of skill level is required.
Shinboy, I have a question.
Go. Mm-hmm.
Go for it.
It's specifically in relation to Guild Wars 1 speedclears. Do you see a lot of like more and more specialized builds and more splits wherein like you've like this dungeon, if you want to get this most efficiently done, you're going to need like an SOS or an emo bonder or a T1, T2, T3, etc.
I can see that with specific skills. like right. not like you need to run this, this, and this, but like I could see like with COF, for example, you need at least one like Greatsword Warrior, and you need at least two right. people with team wide swiftness,
and maybe team wide stability, because I do that maybe for two. That.
Yeah, but yeah. I mean that's not overly useful because that's only for 5 seconds.
But this is definitely a lot more, you know, flexible than Guild Wars 1.
Yeah, like I've been bringing along, like I said, whoever wants to come along, and I'm pretty sure I've had at least one person of each profession, and the times don't really vary by more than a few minutes.
Right. Right. But the idea of a speed clear is to get it as fast as physically possible.
Yeah.
If we had two Ellies for the last bit, that would be
two Ellies. The last boss would end in less than a minute.
So give us an idea of Citadel Flame Explorer mode, the path you're doing, and I don't want you to spoil too much, but I definitely want to at least discuss your reasoning behind your choices, and give me an idea of what your choices have been for your optimal speed clear current idea.
You mean in specific to Citadel Flame?
Yeah, may as well choose that one, so that's the one you've developed the furthest.
Okay, so a lot of AoE DPS and a lot of team swiftness, because the way it's laid out, there's a lot of running to objectives.
Right.
So, I'm not going to spoil too much.
Yeah, that's pretty much perfect. So, there's a lot of running to objectives.
Yeah, you need to, like, go to one, like, run across one thing and then run back at right. one point.
Is there any protection or anything like that in there?
Yes. No, at least, yes, but it's not needed. You can go straight DPS. A lot of the logic behind speed clears, specifically in this game, because there's no, like, shadow form where that's, like, all of your defense right there. Is pretty much kill everything before it kills you.
Right. Okay.
Except for that one part where we avoid everything before it kills us.
Yeah.
That kind of gives you an idea of what you need in terms of classes. So you're looking at what? Was it two Ellies, two Warriors, and a Guard?
Yeah, or maybe switching out one of the Ellies for a Ranger, because at some points traps are useful and they also have a really good team-wide swiftness.
So those choices are specifically for what, single target DPS by the sounds of it, AoE DPS, and a lot of stability in there, a lot of swiftness in there. I guess
yeah,
in more
not
runs.
A whole yeah a lot of like what I usually run with is I run with Greatsword, then Sword Warhorn, and then I switch to range. I just got my rifle from the dungeon for the boss instead of Sword Warhorn,
right?
But yeah, a lot of pretty much just straight DPS. For most of the challenges, you need AoE.
Right.
And there's one part where there's a lot of kiting involved, so swiftness is pretty important.
So I want to highlight that, because that is kind of the reasoning behind all the choices made in high level. I'm going to call this high level dungeon play, because it is. Like, it's fair enough. Like, speed clear is the top tier of PvE play, in my opinion, in terms of just how on point you have to be and the level of required commitment and specialization of each person playing. So we're talking about top level PvE. You're looking at not the classes people are choosing, but the applications those classes are for. Like, would you agree with that?
Yeah, because you could easily switch out. You could easily switch out that second warrior for like a guardian if they have high enough DPS, because the extra stability will definitely help.
Yeah,
and like, so that's not set in stone, but the roles are set in stone, not the professions.
Yeah. So how do you guys feel? Well, Dourin, are you still with me? I need to check every time, because he could pass out any moment. Dourin, you there? That's new.
I think he said he went AFK.
I think he's gone again. All right,
and he still doesn't come back.
Noob Rama, what are your thoughts here on that specific mentality? Do you think have you run a speed clear yet, Noob?
I haven't in Guild Wars 2, but I spent well over 100 hours running one speed clear over and over again in the original Guild Wars.
Right.
So
only 100 hours.
Over in one speed clear. For MTS.
Only 100 hours?
Yeah, only 100 hours. Fuck you.
I've probably spent upwards of 500 doing Fissure of Woe.
Yeah, but I maxed out Kurzik thanks to MTSC.
So, how would you compare top-level PvE in Guild Wars 2 to top-level PvE in Guild Wars 1?
The question is, PvE, the difference is top-level PvE, like, once you get the speed clear down, it's no longer a matter of skill, it's just you doing your job. Mm-hmm. So I'm hesitant to call it top level PvE.
Right.
I've noticed that like this seems a bit more dynamic than the speed clears in Guild Wars 1, whether it's because we're just not that good at them yet.
Yeah.
Or maybe it's because the dungeons are buggy.
Like while I love
you mean we had to cancel one run because the NPC broke?
because the NPC got stuck in a wall.
Oh, man.
Like, while I love doing repetitive tasks, I'm quite hesitant to call this, like, really high-level PvP.
What else would you call high-level PvP? That's kind of the problem.
There's no other thing. It's just...
Yeah.
You can go farm ore, like everyone else does.
Down, right. If you get your roll down, it's no longer, you know, I don't know.
It's dungeons and farming. That's end game right. PvE. From my perspective, as a PvP player, I that's how I view it. But either way, how do you feel about the fact that in Guild Wars 1, let me break it down. In Guild Wars 1, I feel that for a proper high level speed clear, it is essentially an entire build set for each person playing, and each person player has to do exactly.
There's generally one.
See,
or
this
two
is
variations.
This is a lot more flexible,
right?
Like right off the bat,
Noob.
Like, even though there were one or two variations, I think it's great that they're adding flexibility because, I mean, like, you know, sorry, you picked a Mesmer. You can't join us on this MTSC run, et cetera, et cetera. So this flexibility definitely makes it a lot more accessible to everyone, which right. I think is great.
Okay, except I'm going to say one thing. Mesmers are actually pretty useful.
If that Mesmer ever uses that skill in front of the NPC again...
No more Mesmers. I'm out.
Anyway, I'm saying, I've noticed, like, Necros, I love you guys, not super useful for this run.
Ooh, interesting.
Right. Just well, not high enough DPS for the boss.
Right. Okay, that is actually an interesting point. But at the same time,
like, it depends whether you're doing these speed clears just for the sake of having lots of time, or like, maxing out time, or just getting the benefits of the rewards, which a lot of speed clears are about.
Well, yeah, like I'll bring Necros along because most of the time,
like,
I'm just chilling. I don't care
usually,
how long it takes as long as it's
at least it
it's
might be different for a casual like me compared to the expert Shinboy, but it's getting it at least this amount of time. Say MTSC, you want to get a minimum of 25 minutes. So as long as you're within a time frame, it's fine.
You mean maximum 25 minutes?
Maximum, sorry.
Yeah.
One question. You think cons? You need cons for any speed clear, Shinboy?
The potions for that specific dungeon help a lot. Like there's for example, I think there's one for every dungeon if you check the vendors.
You can get the recipe. You can buy the recipe.
You can
recipe,
also get them out of the chest.
I need one silver to the...
So just to clarify here, in Guild Wars 1, consumables played a large role in dungeons, if I'm not incorrect.
You needed them.
You needed them.
Yeah, but in Guild Wars 2, the main consumable that you'd be considering using, aside from the magic find one, which is... probable.
It's not
in a
necessary.
Lot of cases. Not necessary, but probable. There's a consumable for each dungeon, which generally has increased damage against X enemy type. I think it was.
It's like a blessing you would get from the original guild.
It has that, and it has decreased damage taken from them.
Yeah. So it's in general, and you can get them. I found them in the story mode quests, let alone the explorable mode. But literally, they come as drops, or you can buy them off the auction house because you can actually make them through. I think it's cooking only. I believe.
You also get them out of the chest throughout the dungeon.
Yeah, so in general, you're looking at getting these cons and applying them for the entire... Would you say you would... My main question is, it seems like the general idea of Guild Wars 2 is kind of being implemented here if you're not going for world's first, like world's best. That's the only time I can see people just going, no Necromancers, or no X, because you need Y. But how do you feel? Would you think there'd be any point where you would start implementing that kind of strategy? Or do you think there'd be any one thing you'd force upon people, like, for example, taking those cons?
If I'm in the mood where, like, okay, guys, I want to try and set a record, I'm inviting specific people and making sure they all have those things.
Would it be by choosing those people based on the class or the people?
Both.
Okay.
Go ahead.
No, okay, finish yours and then Noob asks a question.
Just be like, okay, you're level 80, but I don't know if you're that good at this run. I'm not going to invite you.
Right. So that's like fair.
That. But that's just me. That's not in general.
Man,
like,
I'm going to be running friendly New Baramas casual corner. So these elitists.
I do that all day
anyway.
He said when he's in the mood. I've seen them run dungeons with like the most random group of people and having fun. So that's pretty cool.
I want to take five warriors in there.
That's really nice about these dungeons. It takes a lot less commitment. Just you can literally play any class.
I have to specify, like, these are the main things we're talking about here is for the speed clear. I'd recommend doing explorable mode, like non-speed clears, before you do speedclears and just to have fun with it, because you can just, you literally have, can ping anyone into any of these dungeons. As long as you all know what your shit is about, you can complete them. They've all been doable with any composition that I've seen. Any disagreements there? Like, you guys have done more
speedruns. I've had a bunch of different, I'm pretty sure I've had at least one person of each profession in there, and no one has really seemed like they were completely useless.
Yeah, which is awesome, in my opinion. So, but yeah, that brings me back to that question. Do you see a future where these cons are required?
I don't think so, because it's such a small buff. It's like less than 10% damage. It's like
a 9% something like that. Damage, and then 6%. It's 9% damage to them, and then 6% less damage to you.
Right. So
yeah, it's not going to make a massive difference, but cool. It could help speed it up by like maybe a few seconds here and there.
So to kind of like round out that part of the discussion, we're pretty much just going, hey, speedcures are a thing. They're finally starting to be a thing. I'm pretty excited to see how you guys progress with this, because I want to see how you learn to use your professions in this way.
I'm pretty much gear-wise done with Citadel of Flame now. I got my gloves that I wanted, and I got my rifle that I wanted.
Yep.
But the money's so good that I'm going to keep doing it. But I'm also going to start farming for other dungeons to see if we can experiment a little bit, see what kind of other speedcures we can go in. Depending on what dungeons people want the gear from, I'll just get a general just from the guild, what people want, and then go from there.
So I want to talk about the rewards from the dungeons in a sec, because I want Rvaan to tell me how he's been going, in better commas. Before we get there, one of my major things that I've been really interested in is cross-profession combos. And has that been a thing yet?
It's actually pretty, well, the thing is, you need a coordinated group for that, and a lot of times if we've just been rolling with whoever, people haven't really been paying attention. But like, I know for me, for one, like if I go longbow ranger, the F1 skill for that
is huge. It's awesome.
It's an amazing combo field, and especially so if you have a guardian in there with a greatsword who uses their, like, I don't know what number it is, but their spin.
Yeah,
shooting fire everywhere, it's really,
there's two spins.
It's really useful.
Is it the three or the five? No. Is it the one where
Whirling
Rock comes out?
The World Finisher is really good.
They both have World Finishers.
Really? Okay, there you go. So World Finishers in, like, for example, if a Double Axe Warrior uses...
I believe they both have World Finishers.
If a Double Axe Warrior uses Cyclone Axe, whatever the one who continually spins, like I think it's Whirling Axe.
Whirling Axe, yeah.
That is such a huge combo finisher. It goes for so long. And if
you're a warrior, you can actually lay it down yourself and then switch weapons to axe and then do it.
Then do it. And is you do an incredible amount of AoE. I think it's AoE burning or something?
It is AoE burning.
And burning stack duration. So you can literally stack on so much shit. If you have procs on your axes, so for example, if you have bleeding proc, which you do because if you take 5 points in precision, then you straight up can stack so much DJ on everything around you just by that cross-profession combo. So... yeah, but my main question is, how much do you see this becoming a thing? Are there any ones you would want to pursue, like AoE regen, for example, or AoE retaliation?
AoE condition removal.
I have that.
I know, I'm saying it's useful, especially in this dungeon when there's a lot of burning.
Right. And so that's what, water fields, was it? Or was it a light field thing?
I don't know, ask the Guardian.
I think it's the two, it's a two with one of the World Finishers who just sends out AoE cleanse.
All right, no, but I mean,
and that's why I wanted to get a rifle, so I have a decent ranged option, so I can shoot through it, and then condition removal happens.
Projectile finisher, condition removal, yeah. A lot of these are really cool. Like, I can see elementalists being a huge thing. I'm sad Dourin's not here, because elementalists are going to be a thing. Like, they have the most combo fields in the game for a class, and every other, for example, warriors have the most combo finishers in the class. An elementalist and a warrior comboed for a dungeon is a very good pairing.
Which is why I wanted at least one of each. This quote-unquote perfect group.
I'm here.
Hey, Dourin. So what are your feelings on the usefulness of
LEs? What are your feelings on going to sleep?
What are your feelings on throwing that vodka back high. Up?
Oh, God.
Kind of the
biggest
problem
is
here is...
Vodka is a terrible thing for a podcast.
This is the best.
Oh, it's the best thing for a podcast.
Yes, the best thing.
Why would you drink
Dourin?
Yes.
Well, Shinboy... specifically, these would be stuff.
No, I'm awake, so
yes,
get to me.
Definitely.
No, I'm going to give it to you in a second.
Ask them while you still can.
Those would be staff alleys, right?
Yes, definitely.
Dourin, how do you feel about the fact that you're almost forced to go stab?
Okay, so the way I feel about Ellie's, all right. So this, so for anyone listening,
all right, sit back, guys, sit back.
This will probably be my last bit on the podcast because I am fucking dying after six goddamn screwdrivers and
his livers are failing. Liver failing.
Really? Talking wine. So my wife like
sound good at all.
She did a taste test on a chocolate wine while we were at the store, and she thought it was good. So we bought it, and I drank some, and I'm basically done this.
And
point.
You drank more, and then you drank vodka.
I did. So I didn't follow the rules.
You didn't drink enough vodka.
All right, so all right, Ellie's. I'm gonna break it down. All right, so
shit.
This is gonna be fantastic.
This is gonna be something at least. All right, so Ellie's. I've been playing an Ellie since Beta Weekend 2.
Second Beta. Yeah, Beta Weekend 2. Yeah.
And mostly what I've been playing has been Dagger Dagger Ellie. And up until launch, or more specifically, probably a week before launch, or the week of launch, I was playing Dagger Dagger Ellie, and it seemed pretty goddamn competent. Right. If you played right, Dagger Dagger Ellie felt pretty good in PvP.
Yeah.
It was not viable for PvE. It is specifically for explorables. But in PvP, it felt pretty okay.
Right.
So, I don't know what changed. I don't know if it's the change to vulnerability, or if it's maybe something else. But something changed with Dagger Dagger Ellie, and it doesn't feel like it should. And it feels like if you're going to play an
Ellie... Dourin's a sad panda.
It feels like...
Dourin's a sad panda.
Yeah, pretty much. If you're going to play an elementalist, you kind of have to play staff if you want to be viable. And that's not good.
And that's not good. I kind of agree.
Dagger Dagger does not have a place anywhere in the game, whether it be PvP or PvE or somewhere in between. There's nowhere that Dagger Dagger is viable, and that just is not good.
Yeah, because we're essentially talking about the elementalist melee option.
Yeah,
and that's what Dagger Dagger is, and it's weird because for example, a warrior, if he is in a melee, he can stay in melee and deliver probably the highest single target DPS in the game.
Yep.
I don't believe there's any competitor. Over a large period of time. Obviously, the burst and a thief is better at the moment. That used to be Ellie's. And Ellie used to be, as a Dagger Dagger, the highest single target deeps, especially in lightning with the two hits off the lightning whip. And that used to be really useful. Like, for example, in speedclears of Ascalon Catacombs, killing those mounds, those, what the fuck do you call them?
The graveling mounds?
Yeah. So, those would be, I would assume, a Dagger Dagger would have been, in the past, the best for that. But the way they've balanced Ellie's, especially if you compare it to the Thief, they can't stay melee long in PvE much at all. Or PvE.
See, from what I've heard from my contacts, is that specifically on that run, you need an Ellie, but a Staff Ellie for that
staff
particular
Ellie.
Part.
Yep.
Yeah, and straight up, like, well, Dourin?
That's pretty much it. When it comes to PvE, Staff Ellie is pretty much the only way to play Ellie. And that's kind of sad.
Yeah, and... In PvP, it's Staff Ellie and maybe sometimes Scepter Friend, yeah. Scepter Dagger.
Like, your way of playing like the edgy Ellie is playing the Scepter Dagger. And Dagger Dagger just doesn't have a place.
Yeah. And so it's the main thing there is the Ellie can't survive in melee range. Unlike a thief, which has the ability to be an evasive thief, to some extent, they can just switch weapons. Like they can burst in melee, dodge back and switch to their pistols and be a decent range for a bit and then go back to melee when their defensive cooldowns have come back. But Ellie, without weapon swapping, kind of doesn't have the option. There used to be water used to be the main option for that because of how good vulnerability was. I feel vulnerability is much weaker than it used to be, especially with the durations on it and the fact that you're only doing one stack per hit now, still,
well,
there's only 1% damage.
And more specifically, the fact that it's a like damage taken percent as opposed to armor reduction, which is what it used to be.
Yeah, it used to be an armor reduction, but it's weird because when you have 25 stacks of vulnerability on something, it does feel like it does more now than it used to for some reason.
It's a thing where, like, back in the day when it was more of an armor reduction thing, like, as a dagger elementalist, you felt like you had a purpose. Like, as a dagger Ellie, you were there as specifically as a vulnerability dagger Ellie. You were there to, like, you were the counter to the defensive guardian or the defensive warrior.
Yeah.
Whereas now, with the way they changed vulnerability to be a percent damage per stack, you don't really have a place anymore.
Yeah, and PvE, we talk about, again, Graveling Mounds. For example, if your previous main W application was to inflict vulnerability and then burst, you can't do that because it's an object. So, and it's immune to all conditions. So, for example, a Scepter Ellie using fire would be completely fucking useless against a Graveling Mound. Yep. In fact, a lot of the Scepter Ellie stuff, even though I know Dragon's Teeth is good, I know Phoenix is good, but compared to Meteor Shower and Lava Font, you got nothing. Yep. It's so weird that, especially for the Elementalist, the balance is just off there. I just wanted to bring that up as a discussion point. But yeah, as Shinboy said, going back to dungeons, staff elementalist seems to be a thing.
And it's not like staff is overpowered. It's just that everything else is not as good.
Yeah, not up to snuff, in my opinion. It's not quite there. For daggers, they just need to be able to... They just need to give Ellie's a little bit more evasiveness, a little better defensive cooldowns, and that would be fixed. Because the dagger damage is fine. It's just that an Ellie in melee range gets fucking destroyed by anything.
Yeah.
PvP or PvE. And they fixed Thief to a large extent, but they haven't really fixed Ellie yet. And Scepter, again, Scepter is more of a conditioned weapon. I don't think that's a problem they could fix because that is the focus of the Scepter, the burning on the main attack. I know lightning does okay direct damage, but not as much as daggers or staff. It's just a weird thing with Scepter in PvE at the moment, but it's specifically the only thing I can see forced upon people is Ellie staff. But would you say, Shinboy, that you can think of anything that you'd force upon other players? Like, for example, would you make a warrior run a greatsword?
Yes, definitely.
I really? Because double axes is pretty good.
Not as good as 100 blades.
Do they still have a thing with those with stuff that gives it a weird hitbox? Because that fucked us when we tried 100 blades on the explorable.
Not with... Because there are nests like in the run that we do for COF, and there's no issues with that. Apparently, there's still an issue in AC.
Right.
But for the rest of that run, I would still have Greatsword because with the way I'm spec now, I hit one of the bosses for 16.5k with 100 blades, and that's on a 6.5 second cooldown. So why would you not run that?
Yeah, and you're currently running Glass Cannon Warrior, right?
I wouldn't say completely Glass Cannon. I still have like 21,000 and change health.
Right.
But I'm pretty much spec'd just for DPS. Like, I have like almost 3.4k attack. So
just specifically, you're mainly wearing Berserker's gear and Knight's gear. Is that correct? Or mainly Berserker's?
Mainly Berserker's.
There you go. So yeah, that
the only thing is I got the condition damage rifle because the auto attack stacks bleeds. That's the only reason I went with that.
Yeah, and it has huge precision on it, so why not? So that's an inch. So do you think that's something you'd see across other classes? Would classes be pigeonholed into specific weapons?
Depends on the dungeon, but I could say definitely yes.
I'd actually somewhat agree with you. Like, from what I've seen so far, for example, a guardian. Like, well, Rvaan, what's the guardian position in these runs? Like, what's your general role, and how do you play it?
I just go in with my normal.
He dies a lot. That's how he plays.
I go down a lot. It's because when they drop me, it's just I have two ways to get up, and one of them does not give me a chance to get away quick enough.
Right. Well, what is this? Could you go into more detail? Like, what's the main problem with Guardians? Well, your build, at least?
It's really just like in this one specific spot, if I go down, I'm probably not going to get back up.
Is it a single target high damage, or is it more of an AoE effect?
That's it's more of these enemies will keep you... downed for an infinite amount of time.
Yeah, they'll knock lock you pretty hard.
Yeah. Oh, okay,
save yourselves.
Well, the problem was, what is it? Retreat? No, not even retreat.
Yeah, is it? Yeah, retreat.
It's one of the. Shouts that adds stability.
Oh, that's stand your ground.
Stand your ground.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I use that to get up and run away.
One of the best shouts in the game. Like, cause the same kind of thing happens in Stonebreakers is something I do want to. We don't really have too much time to touch on because almost at 3 hours now. But in AC Explorable, Aslan Catacombs, the Gravelings who knock you down will kill you before you can get back up. Like, there's little things like that I can see forced upon people.
Oh, right, I remember that. Oh, fuck that run.
Yeah. There's little things like that can be forced upon people that I can see slowly developing into what I hate about PvE, which is the forced specific builds. Like, for example, I can see it eventually being the case that it's most efficient for people to pack a stun brick and then bring a specific weapon, and you see it going downhill from there. I don't know.
Carry a scepter specifically for that dungeon.
Well,
I feel like it's so much more different in Guild Wars 2. It's just a lot more flexible, and I don't think you will turn into like
it's flexible if you want to get it done in a respectable time, but it's not flexible if you want to set records.
Yeah,
right. But I don't know.
I don't know.
Like, people out for records, because I sure as hell was not out for records when I did Speedclears. Like, maybe sometimes, but that was never the main purpose.
I ran a few Fisher of Woe runs when Ursin was a thing that set records.
Awesome. Would you want to? Do you see much of a community building around that yet, or is that something you want to pursue?
Okay, this is something I really want Innit to add. If I could add one thing to the game, they need to add the time in the dungeon to slash age.
Right. Yeah. Time and instance. Yes.
All right. Yeah.
That is added, no community can form, because the way I did the 19-minute run screenshot was I screenshotted the time left on the potion that we were discussing before about the reduced damage. It had 11 minutes left on it, but that could easily also be, because it'd be 49 minutes.
Well, alternatively, you can enable the clock on your minimap and screenshot your screen at the start of the dungeon, screenshot at the end of the dungeon.
Yeah, but it could have been a different day. You could have been
you really want to do that, you could. But one last question that I didn't get to ask was, have you ever done a Molotov trail, or not jQuery, MTSC or MSTC or whatever it's called?
I did the Kurzik one with all the Earthshaker warriors.
These guys are talking about Guild Wars 1 dungeons. Just to be clear, this is the specific dungeon in Guild Wars 1.
So, you know at the beginning where you can get like a short blessing? Is that what the cons are like, or are they more like actual cons?
No, it's more like the short blessing where you gain... It's pretty much you gain more damage against a certain enemy
type. So it is nearly entirely optional.
It helps, but it's pretty much optional, yeah.
Right.
So yeah. Okay. So the last thing I want to talk about today, as we're hitting up against our limit. Rvaan,
that's what she said.
Tell me why...
Well, that's what Dourin said.
Why are you running dungeons? What are you gaining from doing the dungeons?
Like, I'm gaining over 26 silver a run. And I'm getting the token so I can get my armor.
So, Shinboy, how do you feel about dungeon rewards in Guild Wars 2? And what do you get for rewards? Can you outline for me why you'd be doing explorer mode dungeons?
Because the money's good and the loot's good. That's pretty
much it. And the experience. You get basically a level every time you do that.
I think fucking loot is so high, like, compared to what other speed clears were like.
You get your monthly for Survivor just by finishing the dungeon.
Wow.
That's ridiculous.
From the reward for finishing the dungeon.
I wouldn't be surprised if they gave the hell out of dungeon rewards.
That like, XP is ridiculous longer. Right now.
Well, it's also the first time you do a run per day, you get 30 tokens. At least this is the COF. And then every time after that, you only get 20.
Right. Yeah, that's interesting.
Well, how long are these runs? Like 20, 25 minutes, right?
Yeah.
Probably on average 25 minutes with the groups we've been going with, yeah.
That's about like a silver per minute. That is ridiculously good. Plus the XP bonus as well as the token.
But the thing is, I don't see them nerfing it that much because then it would also hurt the people who just do it like not speed clear wise.
No, that's why I say they'll do it later on. I think they'll just do it later on.
I actually think it's very calculated what the current...
Yeah, the thing is, like, normally, in Guild Wars 1, you could see the speed clears and be like, okay, this is all because they changed Shadow Form or Ursin or whatever. And you can clearly see how they can nerf it or fix it. I don't see how they could fix it because of the way they set up their profession system.
Right.
Like I said, we can do these runs really quickly with any combination of skills.
The only way they'll be able to do it.
The point I was making was that I think that they want it to be high reward for doing these and high reward for doing speedclears because they want to reward speedclears. That's a type of gameplay that Anet has always, somewhat at least, appreciated. On top of that, we're looking at what we talked about earlier today about legendary weapons. Now, you're looking at 250 skill points or so for one of the items, at least one of them. That's 250 levels you need to get, which is 250 runs of a dungeon, if your math is correct. And then that is also easily enough to give you an entire set of the armor from that dungeon, I believe.
That is easily enough to give you an entire set and every weapon you need and then some.
Yeah. So, like, I don't know about that.
I don't need to calculate that.
No, well, it's very close because you're talking about like 300 per set, like per item.
Yeah. And anyway, moving on.
But it's kind of set. It makes like mathematical sense to me. That sounds like exactly what the aim is. If you do,
if you're doing all those dungeon runs and you only get one weapon out of it, that's kind of lame.
Yeah, but you actually get. But as it is now, you can get an entire set of the dungeon.
No, I mean, like, just silver rewards. Like, just general money. I think that's a bit too high. One silver per minute?
Or is that too high? Like,
not counting the items we get from the chest? Because we can...
Yeah, not
counting. Shinboy's gotten multiple items he sold for gold.
Like, 2 silver, 3 silver?
I actually think...
Yeah, but they're also not endgame.
The opposite is the problem. I think that endgame aura events and stuff don't give you enough money compared to dungeons.
Yeah, you get, like, 1 silver and change for doing those events.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As opposed to dungeons where you're getting a silver a minute. And those
and
events take 20 minutes.
Like 400 karma, maybe?
Yeah, exactly. Do you get... So the only thing you're really missing from dungeons is karma rewards, right? Yeah.
I have karma. I have 100,000 karma.
How? What the fuck? That is actually a lot of karma. How'd you get so much karma?
Every time the Claw of Jormak shows up, I try and run over there.
All right.
It's 5 events in quick succession. And each one gives you about 400 karma.
Right, and you do knowing Rvaan, he does it pretty much every Jormak spawn, because he's crazy.
And
that
that's literally like 23 hours a day.
It's only every 3 hours.
There you go. But that's only one robot.
We've popped out of COF, saw Jormak was up. We all went there, did the Jormak chain, then came back and continued doing speed clears.
Yeah, like straight up. And there's other world bosses as well. Like for example, the south
Shatterer, because he's crazy and it destroys my computer. And
right.
It's not good.
Yeah, he's not fun.
Kekwal is interesting.
Oh, the
it's
one.
Fun.
And there's the destroyer thing.
I forgot about the Mega Destroyer. I haven't done him in a while.
Mega Destroyer is easy now. Like, I think he's been bouncing.
Where the hell is he?
It's in Mount Maelstrom.
Maelstrom
check out the podcast. He's actually inside the volcano.
To the northeast of Ara. Straight up. There are world bosses, and that's probably the most efficient way I know of to get karma. And then you have dungeons, which is the most efficient way of making silver, and getting mats to some extent with your silver and drops and so on and so forth. The only thing I see as significantly unbalanced here is the endgame events, like specific Ara. It doesn't seem to give you enough at all for what you're doing there.
Hurrah.
It sounds better.
What do you... So, what do you guys agree with me there, or do you think that dungeon should be toned down?
I haven't.
I think
considering
how expensive
days.
Waypoints are in comparison to the rewards, I think it's just you need to get those events more because they take a considerable amount of time. You know, at least
the events in
Iraq.
Yeah,
but I think dungeon wise,
how much
their
you
balance
get?
Just
like,
fine, like rewards.
Like you get 3 silver, and then now you want a waypoint somewhere else. Oh well, good luck to
there's 3 silver.
Thank you for that 3 silver plus more. Let's be honest. It costs way more than that.
So you relatively agree with me that dungeons are pretty cool in terms of rewards, and I'm actually advertising to everyone listening, hey, consider doing dungeon speedclears if you are down on cash, because it definitely seems like even better than playing the auction house. Like I make similar money by spending the same amount of time playing the auction house, which is a
grinding
lower...
Grinding and getting legitimate rewards is kind of weird.
I'm
fucked over when I'm grinding. I genuinely do. Like,
today,
for some reason, I get
some
sort of weird fun out of doing repetitive stuff that brings no rewards.
Yeah, like, today, for example, I had, like, 20 silver after buying a whole bunch of random bullshit. I was like, I need money. And I just threw it in guild chat. Yo, I need money. Who wants to do dungeon speedclears with me?
Yeah, and there you go. And so, Well, obviously, playing the auction house is something that's worth its own episode. But that's definitely a way to get cash, especially if you can only log in every now and then and you don't have time to just sit down and do some legitimate PvE.
Right.
But if you're out there and you're bored, I'd recommend trying this out. Because speed clears and dungeons is a thing. And I just hope it doesn't become like it was in Guild Wars 1. I hope it stays as happy-go-lucky and free-for-all as it is now.
Being like one of those few people who enjoyed grinding, I hope it becomes no rewards and all grind.
Indeed.
I'm bending over.
The grind is the reward.
That's the episode of Lincolncast. Unless there's anything else you want to talk about, Shinboy, is there anything else you want to talk about for dungeons?
Yeah, if you're in Lincoln Force, keep an eye on Guild Chat, because I will be starting to form groups for all kinds of different dungeons just to see what they're like in explorable mode.
Oh, yeah, and I want to run explorable mode dungeons so bad myself.
People are always like PMing me and stuff or asking what's going on. Just keep an eye on Guild Chat, because I always throw it there. And go into the Mumble, because I usually give people who are in Mumble, if I'm on, first spots in the group.
Yeah, because Mumble's so good. Like, having voice communication for dungeons, we talked about this before, is almost required.
Oh, yeah, that's one other thing I do require. If you're in Guild, if you want to come on the dungeon run, you need Mumble. Because even if it's not that difficult of a run, if something goes wrong, or even if you just... It's just nice to be able to talk to the people you're running with.
Yeah, and also, we're on Mumble a lot of the day.
You don't need a mic. Yeah. You don't need a mic, but one would be preferable. I like to hear your voices.
Well, that's the thing, right?
People, and I want them to talk.
It gets them hard, man.
In Lincoln Force, at least, and this happens through everything. We have like a bunch of people who log into Mumble like pretty much every day, and we form somewhat of a community within the community. And in general, like, we're also some of the most active people in the guild. So if you want to be like amongst the most active people of the guild and want to a little bit have more involvement, or at least like the high levels of play available to us, and I assume it'd be the same for other communities, jump on your equivalent Mumble service. Jump on Mumble and get to know us, and so we can get to know you, know your strengths, know your weaknesses, and you'll be put in these dungeon groups.
Speed that groups, way you won't be upset groups. When I say sorry the group is full.
Yeah.
Because you'll be in that group.
And for me, like, especially since I'm doing a lot more PvP now, like, if you don't make the PvP team, that's why. Like, I just don't know you. And that is the basis of a community. Knowing people, getting to know people, so on and so forth. Jump on Mumble. Jump in your equivalent Mumble if you're in, for example,
the game. I like getting to know people, so you'll be with me. And we'll have all sorts of sexy fun times.
The Reddit community has a Mumble as well. Like, just jump on there and get to know people. That's how you
Reddit
get into
it. Reddit has a Mumble? That's fucking crazy.
It's huge.
I don't know if I'd ever stop. I don't know if I would jump on that.
I'd be interested at some point. Cause, I don't know. Mumble gets quiet at your guys' time, 3 a.m. in the morning. So...
As long as I realize in the afternoon.
Yeah. I realize I need to go to sleep at 3 in the morning.
And with that, thanks for listening to the Lincolncast. We'll do plugs now.
I have a plug right now.
Noobarama.
The Lincolncast Facebook page. It's at 14 likes right now. It's,
God damn it.
It's as official
this
as it gets.
The worst. Don't.
I mean.
Don't like the Facebook. Don't stop
fight
encouraging
against
him.
Cynic's oppression of legitimate social networking.
Right? Facebook is evil. I can't.
We'll bring
Facebook.
The fight to Facebook. And then we'll fight off Cynic. Let's do it.
Have you become a Facebook person now, Noob? Or is it just this? What? Are you just doing this
I've always used Facebook.
Okay. Good on you,
but,
I guess.
Yeah.
Shinboy Rvaan 2012 is what I want to say.
What was that, Rvaan?
Shinboy Rvaan 2012.
What
running
is that?
On the hashtag Team Brad ticket?
No. Hashtag Team Brad is a sacred thing.
Wait, Shinboy and Rvaan, you have not liked the Lincolncast on Facebook. You better do
no, we have that. Not, and I intend not to.
Thank
I
you.
Probably won't.
Thank you.
I'm going to invite Shinboy to like the page.
And Shinboy has done your plug. Anything else to plug, Shinboy?
Yeah. I haven't been updating my site much, plugandplaygaming.com, but I have been doing... I almost am done with the second piece. A little short paragraph on each dungeon, both story and explorable mode, just my general thoughts on it.
Mm-hmm.
So as I've been going through them, like the first one has like the first four dungeons in story mode and then the first two in explorable. And like I said, I'm almost done with the second one. So I'll have like a Ra and Citadel of Flame and all that in there. So go check that out at plugandplaygaming.com.
Yeah. And would you be interested in doing guides at some point for those or not?
If there's a few runs that I get really good at and I know pretty much all the roles for, I wouldn't be opposed to doing that.
Right.
But that's a lot of writing.
That is a lot of writing. That's crazy.
It's also a lot of dungeon runs.
But that you'll be doing anyway. And with that, thanks for listening to the Lincolncast episode 21. We're of age, guys. We can drink now. And Dourin definitely
Dourin got
demonstrated
started.
God damn, that was amazing. Check us out next week. Bye.
Like the Lincolncast on Facebook.
Please don't.
Thank you.